What is up, everybody? Welcome to Heavy Rotation and Mix Radio here on Mix. We got a big show for you guys. If you guys could see the banner, who is going to be in the house? Abrina, Mark Pelly, DJ Rocky Rock, Mike Swift. It is all coming your way very soon. All you guys need to do right now is follow us. If you're not following Mix Global on Kumu, there's a big purple button right at the top. Press that to follow. And if you are on YouTube and Twitch, please subscribe. We have amazing DJs, artists, exclusive content coming your way, but the only way you can get that is if you are a subscriber. We're going to be starting our live stream very soon. Sit tight and hang out. Mix Radio, Heavy Rotation, we're coming up next.
Time to bring the bass back.
Mix is the beat of our culture. Our stories.
So I see myself having a couple number ones, number one albums.
Spotlighting inspiring content from Generation Mix. The next generation of creators, artists, and filmmakers. Our music. Discover fresh artists first from around the world. Uniquely Filipino.
It's hard to get this energy anywhere else.
Mix is the beat of our culture. What is up, everybody? Welcome to Heavy Rotation and Mix Radio here on Mix. DJ Marlino joining you guys tonight. It is Friday night here in the States. Good morning to you if you are in the Philippines. And we got the beautiful Abrina in the house.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. Very good. Thank you guys for having me.
What is going on, fam? So, okay. So Abrina has this cool bio that I got to read to everybody. She is an R&B pop singer, a songwriter from San Diego. I had no idea you're from Dago. She's known for her Latina flavor, of course. And then she spent a lot of her time touring the world, especially in the Philippines. And I kind of knew that, but I didn't really. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. But she's also worked with artists like Jeremiah, Eric Bellinger, Baby Bash, Clayton William. And yeah, Abrina is in the house.
Hello, what's good? That was a nice introduction. Thank you.
Oh, no, thank you for being here. I know you and I have been trying to connect for like the longest time, and I'm glad we finally had a chance to sit down, talk, hang out, catch up. So let's start with the first San Diego question. What is your favorite taco spot to eat in San Diego?
Good question. That's like my main thing with people that haven't been to San Diego is like you have to get the Mexican food. We have the best Mexican food. I mean, the border is right there. Tijuana is right there. So so best taco shop. I love Fachada, Super Sergio's, Lolita's. Those are more down south. But then my favorite place also is Carina's, and that's more like mariscos. So.
Oh, yeah. Carina's has, like, they used to have
one. I just got hungry.
I'm so hungry right now. Like, my wife is cooking tocino, which is a little bit different than how they do it in. But, yeah, it's like the aroma is all up in my room right now. So, I'm definitely hungry. But you mentioned a couple of my spots. Lolita's is my favorite. Tacos El Gordo, of course, in San Diego. And then Carina's, I used to love their, they used to have, like, an enchilada burrito that you can do with like fish and shrimp. Oh my gosh, it was like a bomb.
I actually haven't had that yet. That sounds amazing.
It's amazing. So Abrina is here. She has some music that I want to talk to her about. I want to start off, the first time I ever heard of you was through our boy DJ Romeo. You did the hook on his song Up All Night, and so it had like the Mariah Carey sample to it. But when he played it for me and we had it on rotation on Mix, I was like, who's Abrina? I've never heard of her before. So maybe talk to us a little bit how you connected with Romeo on doing that track.
So Romeo is from the Bay, and a lot of my homies are from the Bay. So I just ran into Romeo, like being in the clubs out there, performing out there. My manager is from out there, and the label that I work with is from out there, Empire. And so, I know a lot of Bay people. And he's always been just the coolest guy ever. And he hit me up. He was like, yo, Green, I need you to do this. And like, I've literally went into the studio like five different times on that song. Like, we kept changing the words, like every little note, everything. He was he was pretty picky about it, but that's a good thing. It came it came out really good. Like, that's how you have to be. So
now, yeah. Whose idea was it to sample the Mariah Carey song?
That was his idea, actually. Yeah, he gave it to me with the sample and everything. And I actually re-sang her part on the sample. I was a little iffy about it. I was like, oh my God, I don't want to sing a Mariah Carey part. But yeah, I did it.
Well, you crushed it. So for everyone watching right now, let's play a quick sample of that song, Up All Night by DJ Romeo featuring Abrina. Watch this.
Hey.
I mean, like I said, for anyone who can sing a Mariah Carey hook, the first question is, who is that singing? So you crushed it. So that's kind of how I first took notice. And so, Abrina, you haven't been doing this for a short amount of time. You've actually been doing this for a while. I think like 2012 was one of the first times like you put out music, right? Or something like that.
It was like 2013, 14. But yeah, anything I was doing like before that, I was just like trying to figure it out. I was like young and didn't know what I was doing. But yeah, like ever since I was like a teenager, I've been hustling in this and like won a singing contest when I was 18 and then finally put out my first song like right when I was like 21. So yeah, like I've been like putting in the work for a long time, and it's been a journey. It's been, I've been able to see places that I've never thought I'd see, and like visit places like the Philippines. So it's been amazing. And like, it's just definitely been full of a lot of, it's been a roller coaster ride.
So as an artist on the grind, what would you say is the most challenging aspect of being an artist today in our era right now?
I would say the most challenging thing is really development, because you have the internet and you don't have labels and like people telling you like, okay, like you need to stick to this sound and like move like this and do this. I feel like artists, we're just like shooting in the dark and like trying to figure it out. And it's, there's so many artists and it's so saturated. So I feel like being a focused artist and very developed and have a clear sound and a lane. And then like, also I think the hardest part is like really like getting your right team together.
Yeah. I've heard that a lot from other people too. Now, let's go back to the first song that you ever put out. Talk about the nerves, like how nerve wracking was it for you to launch it? Did you hesitate to launch the first song, or did you say, screw it, I'm just gonna put it out there and see what happens?
Oh my God, I was so nervous, because it's like, I'm afraid, what if people don't like it? What if they say bad things about me? What if they don't like my singing? It's like all these nerves. And then my first video, I was like, oh my God, I don't know. Like, do I look good? Do I look fat? That's how us girls are. We're like, uh-oh, I have to be skinny, oh my God. So yeah, I was definitely going through all of that
On your bio, obviously, you know, you call yourself an R&B pop artist, but if you can really describe who you are as an artist, like in three words, what three words would those be?
I would say I'm definitely ambiguous, because I don't like to be in a box. I like to be free to do different genres and fuse everything together. I'd like to say I'm experimental and creative.
I think so. Yeah. I mean, like, I've seen like your streams on Kumu. I see you get down, and like, you definitely have a lot of vibes that is very catching, eye appealing, and things like that. So let's talk about one of these songs. I think you released this maybe last year. It's called Escape. Now the song in itself is a bob. The video in itself is amazing. I love the scenery.
San Diego,
of course. What was going through your mind when you were writing this? Like, what types of sounds were you hearing? What types of lyrics, you know, were going through your head as you were trying to, you know, put this song together?
Yeah, when I first heard the track, I was like, oh my God, it just took me back to like my favorite place in San Diego. So actually, I have like, this song led into me creating my whole EP, which I named everything after my favorite place in San Diego. And it started with Escape, because Escape was like, okay, I'm thinking about being on the beach right now in San Diego, my favorite place. And like, I'm just in like my happy place. So I literally wrote the whole song about my favorite place in San Diego, which is Sunset Cliff.
Sunset Cliffs.
And actually that's the name of my EP that's coming out very soon. So
amazing.
Yeah. All right.
For those of you guys who've never heard of the song Escape by Abrina, check this out.
How to explain that you just have to see the view. I've been around the world still coming to you. Oh, I know a place that we can escape. Ooh, let the sound of the waves take you away. When I'm set you free, you take it all in. Privacy, nobody calling.
Yeah, see, that's the vibe right there.
You know, doesn't that make you want to go to the beach, light one up, drink a little bit, chill?
Especially right now. We've been all stuck in quarantine for like forever.
Right.
Really quick on Kumu, got a shout out. JR, the king of R&B in the Philippines, tuning in to you right now. What's up, JR?
What's up, also JR? To
Danny Boy, James is in the
Danny
building.
Danny Boy. What's up, James?
Let's see who else we got here. We got SC Tori, also to Moy Bull. I think that's how you say that. But they're all tuning in on Kumu right now. And how do you like Kumu? I wanted to ask you that because you've been on there a lot more. I'm starting to see you stream even more. What do you love most about hanging out and streaming on here?
I definitely have become a Kumu lover, definitely. Like, I think it's so dope how it's such a way to engage with people and yeah. Everyone will be in there just all around the world. It's like such a cool way to connect with people in the Philippines or just anywhere in the world. Yeah. And I love how it's like you can broadcast your own show. Like you literally can just put on your own network and your own show. So I think that's really, really dope. So
yeah. And then of course you're Latina. Like, what do you love most about the Filipino audience that is embracing you when you're on here?
I love it. I first grew up in San Diego in a place called Mira Mesa, and which is like 90% Filipinos. So I feel like I've just always been so close and connected with Filipinos. I feel like Mexicans and Filipinos are alike anyways. So
we're very similar. We're kind of similar as far as the cultures go. Yeah.
Yeah, very. All my best friends are like Filipinos too, which is funny. But
So you grew up in Mira Mesa. Did you go to Mira Mesa High School?
No, I moved from Mira Mesa and then went to Poway. San Diego.
I know San Diego.
You know San Diego pretty well. Yeah. Yeah.
They got a Max's there now. So next time you're down in San Diego, we got to link up at a Max's and get some chicken sisig.
Oh my God. Don't tempt me.
So Abrina's in the house for everybody tuning in right now. She has an EP coming up soon. You're checking out some of her songs here on Heavy Rotation and Mix Radio on Mix. And let's talk about the production side of everything that you're doing. Like, how do you start with a song? Like, what do you go into first? Do you start with lyrics? Do you start with the beat? Do you start with medley? Or just kind of whatever comes to you is how you approach it?
Yeah, I'm most of the time I'll have the beat and I'll be like, okay, what is it? What do I feel right now? What am I going through? What am I inspired by? And then I'll start writing to it. But sometimes I'm like, I'll hear a melody or something in my head.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, ooh, that was dope. And you know what I've been doing lately? I've been having dreams and like I'll have a melody in my dream. And then I'll wake up and be like, oh, don't forget it. So I'll sometimes just have something already and then like we'll build off of that. So yeah.
Are you a voice memo type of artist? Like once you hear the melody, you start singing it on your phone, or do you write it down, or how do you approach that?
Voice memo. All the way, baby. Should see my voice memos. They're some crazy.
Okay, maybe we'll make that we'll do a challenge for you a little bit later before we leave. Is play one of whatever is on your voice memo and see.
Oh no, there. I don't know if it's gonna sound good. It might sound crazy.
So you've worked with a lot of artists, right? You're also connected with Empire. If you can open up for any artist, living or dead, who is the artist that you're opening up for?
Beyonce.
Really? What do you love most about like wanting to open up for her?
Well, I feel like she's the best live entertainer. Like she's the best live performer of our time. So I just, I would be like super excited for that. But also I love Bruno Mars too. So
nice. Now, what about if you can pick any artist to do a track with? Which artist are you going to collaborate with?
Oh, man, I'm doing J Balvin or Bad Bunny. Come on now.
I can hear some of that, like some reggaeton, or like they're kind of more on like this hip hop reggaeton Afrobeat tip right now or something like that, right?
Yeah. Like my music, as you guys are hearing, I'm like Latin R&B, hip hop, pop. I like to just fuse stuff together, but I love to sprinkle in my Latin elements. So like I work with Latin artists all the time. So
yeah.
You know, that would be lit.
I hear that. Now, what about San Diego? Like, how would you say the music scene in San Diego is like? Do you feel like you benefited from being in San Diego, or how has San Diego shaped you as an artist?
San Diego is just a dope city that has so many amazing musicians and bands. And like speaking of, I went to Poway High, so like that's where Blink-182 went to school, and like obviously way before me, but it's still. And then San Diego, we're known for our reggae bands, and we have so many like dope musicians. So I think that musically, like, it allowed me to just have all of these cool inspirations, you know. But definitely, I feel like when I came to LA is when I really started to be like a true artist, though.
Elaborate on that a little bit. Like, when you say true artist, like, how do you define that?
I think it's when you tap into your creativity, and then when you start to understand your sound and where you fit in with music and how you want to be in the world with your music. I think it's more like that. Like, because we all start off singing covers and doing all these like recitals with covers. And then I did theater. Like, so I did all junior theater and stuff. So I was like, okay, I'm tired of singing other people's songs. Like, I want to sing my own song. So when I started writing and like digging into like my creative side is like when I feel like I started to become a real artist.
Yeah. So let's talk about that for a minute too. It's taking that big step from being an artist who just sings covers to then writing and singing your own music. What steps did you take in order to move in that direction? Because I see it all the time. A lot of artists, even like on Kumu, a lot of artists, they have this dream and vision to sing their own music, but they sometimes hold back because they don't feel like they have the right path, or they don't have guidance, or they don't know which way to go. So maybe talk about how you did it.
Yeah, well, actually, that was one of my things that I struggled with a lot, was because I felt like I was getting pulled in all these different directions. I feel like I would be going to studios and meeting producers and writers and stuff, but someone would be like, oh, you sound good on a song like this. Oh, well, no, you should do pop records. No, girl, you should do ratchet records. And like, I'm a pretty like eclectic person, so I feel like I can vibe on every, like, those different types of records. But I had to like literally sit myself down and be like, okay, what do you want to do? How do you hear yourself? You literally just have to envision the best artist version of yourself, and then like make that vision happen and stick to it, because like people always try to take you in different directions. And it's really about finding people that you can work with that will take your best abilities and your vision and like make it come to life. So that's really where I started to like create the best music, is when I got with like dope, really dope producers who I vibed with like that.
All right, so I got a big question for you. So let's say you've sold out arena. There's about 100,000 people in this arena.
Hey.
You have to sing one last song. What is the last song you're singing on stage?
Dang. Okay. I'll probably sing my song Toda Tuya.
Okay, why?
Because Toda Tuya is like my little heart. It's like my little, my song that I created that I just love. Like, I'm just always going to love singing it. It's just, I'm not going to sing someone else's song. I'm going to sing my song.
Okay. Like they say in the Philippines, sample.
Uh-oh. You put me on the spot?
Putting you on the spot, girl.
Okay. Let me do a little sample. Let's take one of your out. Woke up this morning, feeling kind of lonely. Is love even for me? Hope I find someone somehow. Visions of a love life got me thinking about a us life. Letting go to fast life, Big is it all? Nothing but loyalty. Everything good to me. a hoe. I pray his love is pure in a world full of hate. You'll be my saving grace, baby. I gotta do the hook. Quiero ser tú y a toda tuya bajo la luna. Oh, quiero ser tú, yeah, toda tuya, 'cause I know that I'm ready. I hope you don't keep me waiting, yeah. Okay.
Abrina is in the house. Muy bueno. Te quisiera mucho.
Sí. Oh, háblame en español.
Sí, sí, yo hablo en español. Muy poquito, pero I need to practice a little bit more.
Yo también.
So Abrina is in the house. She is an amazing singer, songwriter, R&B, pop artist out in San Diego. And you're based in L.A., right? Or are you still in Dago?
I'm in L.A.
She's in L.A. now. So my girl Abrina is in L.A. So let's do a quick shout to a lot of folks on Kumo right now. 565-440. Hello, Paul. Also to Rina 032490. 612-4312. And Hypeverse says good afternoon. So a shout out to everybody tuning in from the Philippines and all around the world. All right. So let's talk about the Philippines for a minute, because, you know, like you mentioned in the beginning, you've toured around the world. You love touring in the Philippines. What places do you go in the Philippines when you're there? Or what do you remember the most about the Philippines? Like, what cities are the most memorable to you?
Well, I have really only been to Manila. So I haven't been to really the other cities, but there's so many things I've done in Manila. But I know there's so many different cities in Manila. The food, like, they brought out this platter with tilapia, with all the sauces. And I was like, oh my God, I had the best sinigang ever, obviously. And, you know, the clubs are kind of fun. They stay open till like 8 a.m. You get a bottle of Hennessy for like $60.
It's funny how we always end up talking about food on this show. So it's like, and you just reminded me, last time I was in the Philippines, I woke up to a room full of food. It was like a buffet, right?
Oh.
Every silog you can think of. Tos silog, top silog, long silog, bong silog, spam silog. I don't even know what silog it was, but there was another silog there too. And then the other part that I remember too, and I don't know if you can relate to this, is the fruit. The fruit there is so freaking amazing and fresh.
Yes, I absolutely remember that. The fruit was insane. That's why I'm saying the food just has me like, oh my God, I gotta go back.
Shout out to Julius Mina from Hawaii tuning in on Kumu.
Hawaii.
Now, if you had a chance to go back to the Philippines and visit any city, where are you going?
I definitely want to hit the islands. Everyone always tells me how amazing and beautiful the islands are. So Boracay.
Yeah.
You know, all the islands that are surrounding, I know you guys have some of the best beaches in the world. So I gotta like take time to like be a tourist and go see the islands.
Yeah. Another place I think you should check out too, aside from Boracay, is Palawan, right? And then the other island, Cebu. If you love lechon, you have to go to Cebu. At least that's what everyone's telling me, is you have to go to Cebu for their lechon. They have like the best lechon in the world.
Ooh. So. I'm there. As long as the world opens up, then I can be there.
You have to hurry up. Open up.
I know. All right,
you guys, Abrina is in the house. So let's talk about this new song you just put out or just released called Boat. So talk to me about Boat. What do you have to say about this song?
So I put my own little twist on Aaliyah Rock the Boat. And I got in the studio with these amazing, amazing musicians that work with everybody. So I just wanted to do like a real sexy R&B song, but keep my Latin elements on it, you know? So
yeah,
it's just a feel good song. For
everyone out there just tuning in right now, Heavy Rotation Mix Radio, let's check out this song, Boat by Abrina. Watch this.
You gotta hold on me. I want it all through the night. I want you to come. Quiero nadar en tu puro amor. I want you to rock my body.
Definitely a Bob Boat Abrino, man. I love the re drum of that. Like, you can definitely hear like the Aaliyah influence in, you know, Rock the Boat, but the drums have this little harder hit to it. Now, was that intentional to flip it like that, or?
Oh yeah, I had to make it 2020. I had to make it slap, you know.
And then one thing I do love about your music is I love the little splashes of Spanish in there. I think like you mix it up with, you know, it's not too much, it's not too little, but it's just like the little hint of it every once in a while, I think is freaking cool. Like, I love it when artists, yeah, like Filipino artists, do the same thing. But is that intentional in your music to do it that way?
Yeah, absolutely. I just, like, you know, I'm Mexican, I'm from San Diego. So I just try to like stay true to me. I want to make this, you know, even though it's R&B, I want to make it me. So yeah, I want to sprinkle in a little Latin flavor, a little Spanish, keep it sexy.
There you go. Well, I don't want to keep you too long. Tell us about the new EP that is coming. Do you have a date for it? And what is going to be on this brand new EP of yours?
I don't have a date yet, but definitely top of next year. It's called Sunset Cliff. And I actually have a feature from the homie King Little G on it. Yeah, and we're working on some other big things. I can't mention yet because it's not done yet, but definitely I'm excited about it.
Amazing. So Abrina's in the house, you guys. Make sure you follow her, stream all her music. Simply just go to Spotify, just type in Abrina. It's like one of the first ones that comes up. You can stream all her music there. And then tell everyone where they can follow you and check out more of your music and what's going on in your world.
Yeah, everyone, make sure you guys follow me at Abrina Music, and it's A-B-R-I-N-A. everything's the same, Instagram, Facebook, all that, follow me. And then all my music is on Spotify, Apple Music, everywhere. So, yeah.
All right. And then what's the one message you want to tell all your brand new fans and the fans that are watching you right now on all our mixers all around the world?
Follow your dreams and don't let anyone tell you otherwise.
Amazing. All right, Abrina, thank you so much. We'll definitely keep in touch because, like I said, you're in pretty much my neck of the woods. So we got to go tacos and things like that down in San Diego.
That's one thing about me. I eat. I'm a foodie.
There you go. All right. So we'll talk again soon. Have a great Friday. Have a great weekend. And thank you again for hanging out with us here on Mix.
Yes. Thank you guys for having me. Much love.
All right, Abrina. See you later. All right, you guys. So what you just saw right now is something amazing that is happening next week. Collective Hustle, which is an organization that's here within ABS-CBN, and their vision is to unite the emerging generation of Filipinos in transforming their ideas into action, passions into profession, and creativity into careers, and to inspire a global culture of collaboration. Guess what? They got a brand new website that is launching next week, and we are doing a website launch party. It's going down November 12th, Thursday, featuring, I don't know if you guys saw the lineup, So Super Sam, Manila Killa, Guap Dad 4000, Illmind, Kiana V, Jeremy Passion, Gabe Bondoc, Miles Medina, Hyrie from San Diego, and Nadine. If you want to go, all you have to do is RSVP right now on their website, collectivehustle.com. The first 50 RSVPs get this free Collective Hustle shirt, but I don't know if it's there yet, so go to the website right now, collectivehustle.com. You have to RSVP to get on this list to watch this amazing show. So that's the website for you right there, collectivehustle.com. Do that right now. Like I said, first 50 get a free KH shirt, and you get to get in on this amazing party. All right, you guys, my next guest on the show. Oh, man, get ready for this. Let me bring him on right now so I can just read his bio here. My man, hey. Mark Pelly is in the house.
How are you, man? How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing well, man. I'm doing well. Thanks so much for asking me to be on here. This is great.
Oh, it's long overdue, man. Like, since I've seen you, the last time I saw you, and I'll talk about your bio in a minute, but you know, you're part of a group called Magic. And Magic had this amazing song called Rue that everyone was singing all around the world. And so Mark Pelly was the guy who wrote the hook for Rude. Yay!
Thanks, brother. Thank you for that, man. Yeah, that's definitely. I mean, really fortunate to have a song like that to connect it with so many people, for sure. Thank you, man. Thank you.
Oh, definitely. So let me read your bio, because you have one of these bios that we definitely need to read, that people need to hear.
You don't even have to if you don't want to, man.
No, I want to. We're gonna do it. I have it queued up here, ready to go. Okay. So. Okay. If you guys don't know, Mark Pelly is a singer, multi-instrumentalist from Toronto. He currently resides in LA. He's a guitarist and co-founder of Magic. And their song just freaking blew up all over the place, all over the world. I know a lot of you guys were singing that song, but he is in the house. He's also a singer, songwriter, producer who's co-written records with artists like J. Cole, Chris Brown, Shakira, Anthony Hamilton, Trey Songz, Sabrina Caledio, JoJo. I could keep going. There's a whole bunch of them. But he's here because he's also an artist. He has some amazing singles that are out right now. He definitely has this dope vibe. And I'm so blessed that we have a chance to hang out and talk with you today. So, man, what have you been doing? Quarantine is pretty much cooping us all in. So what's going on in your world right now?
thanks so much for the intro, brother. Yeah, man, I'm just honestly just been working hard, man. Just trying to work hard. Essentially, you know, I feel terrible for everyone dealing with the situation that it is right now. And also, you know, I'm going to be honest with you, just the feeling, the political climate right now living in the U.S. It feels a little severe and heavy to me, you know, but I'm just hoping for the best for everyone and trying to work just basically because the live performance end of things have kind of largely dried up, you know, for obvious reasons. You know, we got to discourage congregation as opposed to encourage it, right? So, but because of that very reason, we don't find ourselves in public performing music as much anymore. If you are, you're behind plexiglass screens, or it's, you know, there's things that make it a not a terrible thing, but just different, you know what I mean? We're just trying to navigate through that, man. Trying to do a lot of records. I got a really great opportunity that happened. My signed a deal with Sony China, and I've been putting some records out there in that territory, and some songs in Mandarin. I'm trying, you know, just to, you know, connect. I want to connect with people and just release as much music as I can. Basically, that's it, man. Just grinding away and trying to improve, you know, that type of thing.
I want you to think back to when you first started getting involved with music, whether it was a kid, you picked up an instrument or things like that. What was it about having music in your life do you feel changed your life?
Wow, that's such a great question, man. And I'll give you an honest answer. I hope it doesn't come off too vulnerable or weird, but essentially for me, I think I have an OCD problem. I actually have, like, if something feels like, I'm not going to say it's negative necessarily, but there's something pathologically that's a little bit wrong. And I doing music has been a good thing for me to put that towards, you know, even from a young age. It didn't just present itself later on. And then I kind of always felt this, I guess you can call it anxiety. And it's hard to really know because everyone's subjective character of experience is slightly different. So perhaps everyone is truly feeling the exact same thing that I'm describing. And my situation is not unique at all. But for me, my way of like doing therapy for that was just putting all of myself in music, like distraction of music, more music. And then, but because of that, I truly have a love for it. And I need it, you know, for to help me through the day with pretty much everything, you know. It's a great thing.
Now, what was the first song that you put out that made you officially an artist?
Wow. You know, I guess that would have been when I was younger teen. I put out you know, some music with my friends. We got a Factor grant from Canada, which was like, you know, recognized that they liked the project, so they gave us a little bit of funding for it. We put it out, and that was our first, you know, I guess formal release.
Yeah.
In a band called Ironic Twist, back in my hometown of Mississauga, which is right next to Toronto, Canada, you know. And but that was I guess the first like official release. I was about 15 years old, but since then there's been many, you know. And the thing is, as we all, every person has so much to their past, right? So I don't, but like really, I think it wasn't until I started writing for bigger artists that I think more opportunities that yielded some kind of worldwide kind of, you know, thing happened. And I feel very fortunate for that, because it certainly wasn't like so many people deserve recognition. There are a lot of unsung heroes in the music business. And I don't want to sound super jaded, but just because you've achieved a certain level of success really has absolutely no bearing on your objective worth as a singer or as a musician. It's not really necessarily about that. You can be congratulated for being really good looking or just have some kind of shtick that you do that's not necessarily musical in nature, but nevertheless attracts a lot of people and hooks. You know, we were trying to write a succinct hook every time. It's like a nursery rhyme for an adult, you know, and you want that to stick in your head. And I realize that's guilty of us too. Like I'm in Magic. I love the group. I'm very proud of it. But our song is like, well, you gotta be so rude. So obviously there's like, you're trying to like deliberately write a hit song. It's not like you're like, well, we came to this organically and we no. Like there was like obviously an attempt there at trying to write. And so I've been involved in that process too. And that kind of wore me down, man, to be honest. So like that's, but anyway, I know I'm giving you a long-winded answer to the question, which
that's fine. But yeah. So let me talk about, because you mentioned something there, which was, I think, really important, is when you started writing for bigger artists, right? I mean, how did you even get to that point? Like, what did you have to do in order to get to the point where then you're writing for a Chris Brown or a Shakira or things like that? How would you describe that?
Like, I think the main thing, like, because people have asked me that too, and I don't have a direct answer to how I can ensure that would happen for myself or for anyone else necessarily, because you do rely on a certain amount of contingency and just chance possible, you know, stars aligning to help you be able to achieve these things. But definitely working hard and doing a lot of music, like you're building the catalog itself. So just like, you know, the idea of if you plant a seed, you hope that it grows. If you plant tons and tons and tons of seeds, like if you write hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of songs until it's in the thousands, then your chance of having an income earning song and a song that's going to develop any kind of, you know, notoriety or money or whatever, or just even intrinsic satisfaction, it's only going to happen when you, I shouldn't say only, you could write one song and have that one song be amazing. I'm not telling you can't do that, but generally your chances are better with the more that you do. So I kind of adopted that philosophy early on and I just did so many songs and then got in the room with the right people. You know, like for instance, I'll give you an example. Like I did a co-production for Kevin's Heart for J. Cole, but that's all just because I can't even attribute this to myself. It's because my buddy is T-. I went in the studio with him. We made a whole bunch of beats, and one of the beats that we made went to J. Cole, and then he cut that record over it. And so that's how that co-production went. It's just a couple of producers coming together, and you know, he's done so much great work, and he's an amazing producer, right? Like he's so dope. If anyone doesn't know T-, he's behind so many great records, and he's my buddy. So we collaborate on music, and then boom, that's how it kind of, it's just like that sometimes. But man, so often, way more often than not, it doesn't turn into anything. Like you're just doing it for the love. It's not actually going to do anything, you know. You just
it's about the quantity rather than the quantity of what you're doing, right?
Well, yeah, and hopefully both. It's, you don't want just quantity and no observation of quality, but yeah, for sure you just want to have like a lot of possibilities for songs and stuff. And yeah,
amazing. So if you guys are just tuning in, we have Mark Pelly, singer, songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, part of the group Magic. He's in the house talking about his story, and you've worked with a lot of artists already. Who would you say is your most favorite collaboration?
Oh man, that's a great question. I mean, I've been lucky to collaborate with so many different people. Well, I really enjoyed making a song with Anthony Hamilton a while back. That was great. He's just a great person, great soul, and his singing so beautiful. I had a great experience doing that. But honestly, I've been lucky, man. All the stuff that I've done in the studio, I met so many great people, I made a lot of friends, and there's been so many. It's hard to say that one stands out as being but that was a good memory for me, though. I really did enjoy that, and he's a great guy, and you know, it's just always great to be with him.
Now, you've collaborated with some of our Filipino artists as well. So Jesse Barrera is a good buddy of mine, and so talked about you.
Jesse's your bro. Love Jesse, man. I love him. He's such a good guy. And he's an amazing producer. I met him through my friend Melissa Polinar, who's an amazing singer. You know, I'm sure all you guys know her, because I met her when I was touring with Justin Nozuka years back. I was played with them for 5 years, and I met Melissa at one of the gigs, and I was like, who's this girl? She's so good.
Yeah.
And then we became friends, and that was, but, and then now I don't know if Rocky told you, but Rocky and me, like Rocky Rock, my bro, my pare, we've been making music together. We got one record that we feel really strongly about that we're kind of just finalizing right now and feeling, but we're really excited about it because everyone we played it for seems to be really digging the vibe. So the project I've been working on recently that I'm really excited about is me and him teaming up, and yeah, it's nice. Been great, man. So that's he's actually how I'm even talking to you right now, because you know he put this together to introduce us. So man, it's just been great. You know, I'm hanging with my friends and making music. And I think I told you before, but I didn't tell anyone who might be watching here that Rocky taught me how to make chicken afritada and as well as chicken adobo. And
we're going to talk about that.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I messed up the afritada up pretty bad. But at the same time, like the adobo came together pretty well.
There you go. What out of all the Filipino food, what is your favorite?
Man, you know, I really like going to Jollibee. And when I go to Jollibee, I like getting the spaghetti. Maybe it's because I'm Italian, but I like the sweet spaghetti, like the Filipino style of doing spaghetti, which is essentially still just spaghetti with a tomato sauce, but it has like sugar in it or some kind of like something that makes it sweet, right?
It's condensed milk.
Dude, that condensed milk, that's the secret behind it. Like you put that condensed milk in anything and it makes it taste amazing, you know? Like I love condensed milk. Like I know it's not good for you, but it just soups up the quality of everything. Like, so yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I love that food. It's really good. But I've tried a lot of stuff. I've tried like palabok and all these things, man. I've been lucky.
Dude, Mark is trying all the Filipino food. Well,
not everything, homie. No, but I should mention like my really, really, really close friends, like a couple of my best friends from Toronto is Ricky Tilo and August Rigo. I don't know if you know.
August, I know. Rigo, yep.
But Ricky is the Lady Gaga's guitar player. And August is an amazing, amazing singer, songwriter. He's probably one of the best singers I've heard in my entire life. He's incredible. And we've been making music for so many years. We played in a band together, and for years on end, we played two times a week. So we really formed a strong, you know. So I learned a bit about Filipino culture also just from having really close friends that are from that background, right? But then also, you know, coming here to LA and kicking it with Rocky, and we were even involved in the Filipino American Heritage Month last month doing some events for that. And just like, there's stuff that, you know, I'm lucky to have friends that are, you know, tight with their culture and expose me to it, you know, cause at the end of the day, I'm just learning, right? It's amazing.
Rocky is like the senator, and then August Rigo is definitely family to us. Like, yeah, we definitely, so you know, like, awesome. Small world, man. Yeah. Small world.
You should talk to Ricky too, brother. You should talk
I
to
will.
Ricky. Yeah.
Now the other artist that you did a collab with, which I was so impressed with the song, was Cedric. And Cedric is an artist that was on the Voice here in the States.
I love Cedric.
She also was here. We did a mixtape live concert with her.
Oh wow!
Also did Friendship Games, which is like one of the largest Filipino gatherings. She did their virtual concert with them like a couple weeks ago, actually. Wow. And so,
was telling me about that. I was supposed to play that with her, and then I know exactly what you're talking about.
I
was out of town, but I know exactly what you mean.
Talk about your song with her called Room to Grow. So just go ahead and talk about that, because that's kind of when you and I first started talking as well. Is
song going back and forth, and you were gonna do like a remix of it, and I'm sorry if I didn't send the stems, or I think I sent Cedric the stems. I can't remember if we got it.
Oh, no worries, we'll connect again after.
We'll definitely connect on that after, but I remember that conversation, and like my collab with her, it was just sweet. You know, we became friends. We had a mutual friend that was performing, and then I met her that night and we became friends, and we started working on music together. And basically the way that Room to Grow happened was she came over and she had an idea for the song. She'd already kind of written most of the lyrics, but it wasn't a duet yet. It was just, she had written a verse and another part. And then she largely wrote that song. I got to say, I played the instruments on it and I sang my verse on it, but I think I just had a couple lyrical suggestions. Pretty much all the lyrics on that song are hers, right? Yeah. But it was a collab. We came together and we made the song, and we got a few more that we're about to drop. The next one's called Don't Go, and I'm really excited about that record. I'm trying to actually finalize it now to hopefully release it soon, and it's a really sweet song. I think you're gonna dig that one too, because I know you liked Room to Grow, and that one's definitely, I really like, that's actually my favorite one. I do love Room to Grow as well, but the next one we're about to drop is my personal fave of the bunch. All right.
Yeah, we're definitely gonna have to connect to get that song. But let me play this. Yeah. Let me play your part in the song, because I think the way it sounds, the way you sing it, is just, it's beautiful. It's like one of my favorite songs of this year.
Wow,
so,
dude, wow, seriously, man, damn, bro.
Here we go. So this is "Room to Go" by Sidrace, but it features Mark Pelly on this track. Watch this.
You're everything I want, love. All of you is all that I can get. Wanna take the time to think about another way to live. And I hold the promise you got. There's nothing like the real thing. And you know I don't wanna let you go. Cause I love the way you love me. But maybe we should try to take it slow. My word is all that I got. I wanna be someone you trust.
We can give it room, give it room to grow. But we don't need to be, need to be alone.
Oh man, just that is literally like one of my favorite songs of 2020. Wow. So
thanks for playing that, man. That's really sweet. I'm so happy you like that song. That, that means so much. Yeah.
And like, actually, I want to connect you. My guy, Idrin Artstrong, he just chimed in on Kumu. He is a legendary Filipino reggae artist in Boracay.
Wow. Really?
So he does like dancehall roots, but in Tagalog. In Tagalog.
Wow.
So I would love to connect you with him, because I think with your style, with his influence.
Let's do some reggae together, man. Absolutely.
Yes.
Collab, do some collabs together. I'm down, man. Just hit me up.
There you go. So I'll connect you with that. So let's talk about some of your music. One of the songs I want to start with is Lifetime. Tell me a little bit about this song.
Man, thank you so much for checking it out and knowing about that song. Yeah, basically that song was actually written about 4 years ago. And I wrote it, a part of it with actually the second verse my friend Jordan Benjamin wrote. And he's actually, do you know the artist Grandson?
Yeah,
kind of like you know, like more like kind of almost like Rage Against the Machine style genre, very political, and the riffs are kind of like Rage Against the Machine. Anyway, he's the singer of that, and he's a buddy of mine. He wrote the second verse of that song, but the rest of it was just kind of this idea that I came up with in this, just basically trying to make music in the studio, essentially, and then it sort of came together. And it's I mean, the song actually lyrically is not autobiographical. It's just something that kind of like came to me. I was just thinking, okay, you know, this is a vibe. So I just wanted to, like, you know, try to write a story, create a story through it. Basically, it's a sweet sentiment. And I really love Motown music, you know, that whole period, basically anything James Jamerson played bass on, you know, and that style, I really enjoy that. And so I try to, like, even if I'm doing some modern music, I find myself going to some of the vintage sounds to get that little bit of lo-fi retro feel, which I enjoy a lot. And you kind of mix that together. These days it's cool because you can kind of put some trap elements together with some of the old school Motown lo-fis. It was not lo-fi at the time. It's just that's the recording equipment that was producing that, you know, a tape saturation. That's, I really enjoy that. So I try to, basically that song is me trying to do my version of that genre just writing a pop song over it, basically.
And you can definitely hear those elements exactly the way you described it. So I want to play this for everyone. This is a short clip of Lifetime by Mark Pelly right here on Mix. Watch this.
Thanks, buddy.
You're worth the wait. You're worth the wait. You're worth the wait. You're worth the wait. Even if it takes me a whole lifetime. You're worth the wait. You're worth the wait. You're worth the wait.
Thanks.
Fire.
Yeah, I appreciate that, man. Yeah. My buddy Chris Crutchfield did the video for that. He's such a good dude. Super talented guy. Anybody trying to look for like some video stuff, you know, should definitely hit Chris Crutchfield up. He's amazing.
That's dope. Now let's do a quick shout out to DJ Jenny Pocket. We call her DJ Pocket. She's in the Twitch chat right now. Just wanted to say hello. Also to Chell_9. It's May Day and Kath Neal all tuning in on Kumu. We're about close to 600 people watching you from the Philippines and all around
the
world.
So great.
So,
thank you, guys. Thank you so much for that.
And a cool thing is, I don't know if you guys know, but Mark even has a Kumu account. So you guys can follow Mark. You haven't really streamed on there yet, though, right?
No, I have.
Oh, yeah.
I've done like maybe four or five live performance. I mean, not a ton of them, but yeah, I've done five where I came on and sang a bunch of songs and stuff. I'm down to do more. I really love it. Whenever I performed on Kumu, it's been such a great experience. I get so much love from the people there. They really enjoy, like, us, you know, checking music and very supportive. So I appreciate y'all on that platform.
Now, have you been to the Philippines yet?
I have, brother. I love the Philippines, man. I got to go to Manila and I did a performance there. I wish I was there for longer. And I just heard Abrina say in the previous interview, which I agree with, that I wish I could go again and go to the islands. Like, I know that there's actually, because my friend told me, 7,100 different islands in the Philippines, right? Is that right? Or is it, it's 7,100, right?
The correct answer is high tide or low tide. That's the correct answer.
Really?
On high tide, I believe there is 7,000. On low tide, it's going to be about like 7,100. So that's the correct answer. If you ever hear anyone ask, like, how many islands are in the Philippines, they know what they're talking about when they ask you, well, are you talking about high tide or low tide?
Wow. So when you differentiate between high tide and low tide, that really, like, I got you. Yeah. But still, that's an incredible amount of islands, right? And I know, like, some of them are, like, you know, maybe not necessarily a lot of people there, but the ones like Boracay and Cebu. Is Cebu actually an island? I would love to go there. That would be amazing. So absolutely.
Yeah, Cebu is like, I mean, they just built a brand new airport there. So it's like, it's more easy and accessible to get to Cebu. And then, like I was telling Abrina, they have the best lechon. At least every person I ask, like if you ask a Filipino in the Philippines, who has the best lechon, they always say Cebu. So
gotcha.
You got to go try some of the food out there.
I would so down to try that.
All right. So Mark Pelly is in the house. If you guys don't know who Mark Pelly is, he is a singer, songwriter, artist. He's a part of the group Magic. And he's here to talk about his music and his journey. And we're very blessed to have him here. So let's talk about the song that you just released, Transient. This song is a vibe. When I first heard this, I was like, wow. Like, I just loved it. I don't know. I mean, there's just so much in there to talk about. So maybe dissect it for me. Tell me, like, what went into putting this song together?
Like, how nerdy do you want me to get about it, the answer? Like, how analytical am I supposed to be? Like,
go Mark Pelly. Just...
I mean, like, it's essentially a song that I wanted to write initially for the lyrical idea of it, because there's so many love gain, love loss songs. In fact, I think that comprises the vast majority of all pop music is song about love gained or love lost. But I don't recall a song about transience yet in that condition, right? And that, so I was trying to just basically say that, you know, it's a kind of, I suppose, very negative, not negative, but not entirely optimistic theme for the framework of a song. But basically, I'm just trying to show that there's impermanence to love. Like, we do the very best we can to make things work, but ultimately, I think there's a lot of piece of humanity that there's a transient component to it where I wish that wasn't the case, and that's certainly not the case for everyone, you know. And it's still a beautiful thing for a lot of people, and I don't mean any criticism by the song, but that's kind of like what it is. It's kind of taking that take on it. And then on an arrangement level, I basically just found myself writing this chord progression that was in an odd time signature. Like, there was a bar of six and then a bar of five, a bar of six, a bar of five. And so I just kind of like structured it that way and put, you know, lo-fi trap elements for the drum section. I played bass on it. I played some guitar. I played the keys part. And it's pretty simple arrangement. Then at the end of the song, it does a weird shift where I wanted the production to just surprise you, like take it to a different place. I kind of like doing that. It's like a thing I enjoy is, like, even though I've set up like a genre for most of the record, at the very end I want to do a little surprise just to, like, you know, have people have just an extra, because, you know, sometimes when we listen to a song, even though we might be digging it, we got it, you know, we're like, okay, we're good, we understand the beat, and now it's getting repetitive. So I like switching it up just at the very end to give a different taste. So I did that on that song and people seem to dig it, so I'm really happy that everyone that has heard it cares about it, and it means a lot to me, it's a great deal, you know.
All right, now we're going to let everyone hear this song as well. So this is a snippet of Transient by Mark Pelly here on Heavy Rotation and Mix Radio on Mix. Watch this.
Because we're transient, can't pretend that love is something that will never end. We're
I'm telling you, it's like one thing I love about artists like yourselves is the intricacies of what you put into your music. Like, I almost want to ask you, how many layers of Logic or Pro Tools did you have in creating that song? Because I'm going to guess you had like 36 layers in your track.
I think you're pretty close. I can't remember specifically, brother, but I think you're really close. I think it might even be like that. Yeah. Cause I mean, it's hard to know. Cause sometimes you do stacks of harmonies, right?
Yep.
And then they're not very present, but they're kind of just creating a texture and a cushion for the, so, and then you maybe spread them out. But then that takes up a lot of tracks, but it's not like you're really perceiving it in a sonic sense as being taking up so much information from a, you know, auditory perspective. You're still just getting a, you know, so, but there's a lot of tracks like that where they're just like summing up to be, it looks like it's a lot, but what you're actually hearing is not like this huge, gigantic thing. It's basically just bass, drums, singing, Rhodes, guitar, and then everything else is just like little razzle dazzle elements around that, maybe layers of harmonies and stuff. But I think it does add up to around like 36, 40. Usually it's around 50 like tracks, you know, like, man, crazy.
Mark Pelly is in the house, you guys. Okay, Mark, so tell me what is coming up next for you. I know you got a lot of stuff coming. Maybe break it down on what is the one thing you're most excited for that's coming up soon.
Well, one thing I wanted to mention again is my collab with Rocky, my buddy Rocky Rock, who I think people know Rocky here already, right?
Like, yep, and he's coming up next. He's coming up right after you. Up
next, so there you go. Now you're about to hear from the man himself. And he's my really good friend. And so we're really excited to put out a song called Lie to Me. And that song just came together while we were kicking it, you know, just hanging. And we were actually cooking some food. And then we're like, why don't we write a song? And his buddy Robin was there too. And we started writing the song all together. Then we just worked on it some more. And another buddy, Casper, came over to work on it too. And it was basically just a collaboration of us all. We put this thing together. And that's one thing I'm really excited about. That's coming out really soon. Also, I got two songs coming out through Sony China with my buddy Tat, who I'm super, super excited to release that stuff. He's my good brother. We're doing this together for, that's mostly, I guess, for domestic music for that market. So I might make it available worldwide, but I understand that, you know, those releases are like, not like it's more for an audience that would understand the genre, the lyrics, right? You know, you can appreciate music for the melodic component beyond even just the. Anyway, so that's happening, and and putting out the record with Cedrice, the Don't Go record. That's the other one I'm super stoked to be dropping soon. Oh, one more thing, doing a cover of The First Noel, and August Rego is singing the first verse on it. And nice. It's just, so August is singing on it. Nikki Lee is singing on it, who's an incredible singer. And I'm getting Cedrice to sing on it too, as well as my friend Taylor Green. And it's just going to be this, like, you know, collaboration of different artists coming together to sing on a song. And I actually did something like that recently with my buddy Gaddison, and he had a bunch of people hop on a song, and there's like seven singers or something like that. But it's more just like, you know, showing the love. It's not about like trying to make all this money from music or nothing like that.
Yeah, yeah.
We're collabing and like doing, you know, so I'm really stoked about that. Hopefully we get it done. The idea, of course, is to get it done for this Christmas season. We can put it out, and we got this new version of the First Noel. If we can't get it together, then obviously we could always drop it next year. But we're hoping to get this thing together really soon.
Amazing. So my buddy Mark Pelly from Magic is in the building. Thank you again so much for hanging out with us. You and I can talk for hours. So
we can talk for hours. We'll talk more, man. Anytime.
Yes. Yes.
I appreciate you for having me up on here. And if Rocky's watching, thanks for having me on here too, Rocky. Thanks for connecting me with the homie. And I'm just happy to, you know, be talking to you and just have this thing go down. This is awesome.
And they're throwing you welcome to Kumu gifts right now on Kumu right now.
What?
So
thanks, guys.
There you go.
I promise I'll go on there and do a live stream soon and sing some more songs. And I appreciate you all on Kumu. I love that app, by the way. It's such a great positive thing. So
there you go.
Really, really dope.
Mark, I appreciate you, brother. We'll talk soon. Definitely talk more about music, and then we gotta definitely bring you back, especially when all the new music drops.
Oh man, that would be amazing. I really appreciate it, man.
Very welcome. All right, Mark Pelly is in the house. Once again, you can find him on all streaming platforms. You can find him on all social networks. Just look up Mark Pelly. Boom. He's like one of the only ones that's there. Make sure you support, listen to all his music. Stream the heck out of it. Buy it, download it, repeat. Do that over and over.
Thanks, bro.
All right. So while coming up next, we got DJ Rocky Rock and Mike Swift. But before we get to them, let's show you what is going on with the Filipino community here in North America. It's time for the Tayo Hot List. Check this out.
Yes. 1, 2 racks, I'ma blow that. 3, 4, 5, I'ma hold that. 6, 7, 8, I'ma show that. Show that. Show that.
This was a big week for our community, from merch drops to preparing for the historic election. I'm Kelly, here to fill you in on this week's hot list.
TikTok star turned influencer Bella Porch officially dropped her own merch. For her first launch, which took place Wednesday, Bella made her merch available in limited quantities for a limited time. Her sweatsuit collaboration with LA-based clothing store Rip and Dip was available for only 24 hours, while she only had a limited supply of her black hoodie up for grabs.
It's M to the B, it's M to the B, it's M to the B, it's M to the B. Bam.
Bella rose to fame earlier this year after her video lip-syncing went viral on TikTok, making it one of the most viewed. Prior to being a TikTok star, Bella served in the U.S. Navy, so her launch comes just in time to celebrate Veterans Day next week. TFC's Collective Hustle is getting ready to launch their website, and what better way to celebrate than with a launch party? Partnering with Mix, Collective Hustle will livestream their event featuring Nadine Lustre, So Super Sam, Gabe Bondoc, Miles Medina, and a lot more. Collective Hustle's new site will feature various inspirational interviews with industry experts, masterclasses, and events tailored for the next gen of Filipinx creatives. You can join the party Thursday on CollectiveHustle.com and Mix Global on Kumu. This year's Larry Itliong Festival by the Filipino Workers Center kicked off last week on Manong Larry's birthday with a curbside pickup farmers market by the Filipino Farmers Cooperative from Orsi, California. Part 2 of the event wraps up on Saturday with a virtual celebration featuring Leia Salonga, Ruby Ibarra, Jules Arora, Anigo Pascual, and more. You can join this free event through Facebook, Zoom, or Kumu.
Many of you know this year's election was like no other, and people from our community either ran for office or made sure you got outvoted.
America's finest city is now on the verge of being America's biggest city to elect a Filipino-American mayor. San Diego elected California Assemblyman Todd Gloria to be its next mayor. If his big 13-point lead holds up, Gloria, whose grandfather came to San Diego from the Philippines to serve in the military, will be the city's first mayor of color and first openly gay mayor. From the big city to the Minnesota suburb of Maplewood, disability rights advocate and community organizer Nikki Villavicencio finished first place in the race for city council. Villavicencio, who was born with arthrohyposis, campaigned through the snow in a wheelchair, motivated to make a difference in the community. And the Daly City Council former mayor and current vice mayor, Jocelyn Manalo, is on her way to securing her re-election. Just a reminder, until officials count all the mail-in ballots and verify the results, these counts and projected victories are still unofficial. And while many people hit the polls during this historic election, many folks from our community helped make it happen. In San Diego, J.R. Amor led the county registrar's Philam Vote program that provides Filipino language ballots to voters. This year, 18,000 residents asked for Filipino voting material. AJ Raphael used his voice for a series of Get Out the Vote initiatives, and filmmaker John John Agustavo teamed up with Move On to produce this short video set to the Carlos Bulosan poem, Let Them Know What We Are.
We are the men and women searching in the pages of history for the lost word, the key to the mystery of living peace.
People killing, people dying, children hurt and you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach?
And the Black Eyed Peas teamed up with Jennifer Hudson to put a new twist to their classic Where's the Love with The Love, which features many of the social issues driving people to vote.
Where is the love?
What's wrong with the world,
mama? And that's this week's Hot List. Thanks for watching. Check out more of our videos on Instagram, Facebook, or YouTube. See you all next time.
time to bring the bass back.
Mix is the beat of our culture. Our stories.
So I see myself having a couple number ones, number one albums.
Spotlighting inspiring content from Generation Mix. The next generation of creators, artists, and filmmakers. Our music. Discover fresh artists first from around the world. Uniquely Filipino.
It's hard to get this energy anywhere else.
Mix is the beat of our culture. Gotta love technology, right? What's up, Rocky Rock?
What's up, Marlino?
Dude, the craziest thing that just happened right now, my computer just like, I don't know what it did, it blew up or something, but apparently it died in the middle of all of that. And so I was like praying, okay, get me on as fast as you can. So I had to, it restarted. I had to log in through admin, log in through my own account, and then now we're back. So now I get to talk with my man, Rocky Rock. That is good, dude.
Bro, you almost got lost right there for a minute.
Oh man, that's like one of the things like you don't wish would happen during a live show like this, and it happened. I mean, hey, technology. But hey, we're here with Rocky Rock. He got some dope stuff coming your way. Man, I want to play this track because this is actually the track I wanted to play out of this. But for those of you guys who don't know Rocky Rock, he's an amazing turntablist. He also is an artist. He is, shoot, there's a lot of stuff I didn't even really know about you. So I want to drop this video because I think this video is dope. It was done at BPM Supreme, which is here in San Diego. So check out this quick set by DJ Rocky Rock. Watch this.
Warning. Baby, I'm freaking
as they're saying in the chat, damn, that good, that boy good.
That boy good.
Rocky Rock is in the building. So, man, Rocky Rock, let's talk about your DJing career for just a quick second. When did you start DJing? And, you know, talk about your journey getting up to where you are at right now.
Man, so I come from San Jose, California. Well, I was born in the Philippines, but I was raised there. And, yeah, man, all my life, you know, we've been, all of, you know, Filipinos, we'd be getting into like, you know, b-boying and all this other stuff, you know, and, but, you know, music, as far as DJing goes, I was like, man, that was the thing that really got my attention, you know, and I've always broke rules with DJing, you know what I'm saying? Even when my mom didn't even really support it, I was always the type of guy that was in the room, always just kind of like, all right, I'm doing my homework, but really I'm over there practicing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying, Mom? So, yeah, and, you know, I was always that type of kid that also, you know, was kind of hip with, like, Qbert. Qbert was always the man, you know? So over there, we were always watching a lot of his videos, such as, like, the turntable TVs and stuff like that. So, you know, I'm one of those kids. I came from that, you know what I'm saying? And things just kind of got wild.
So, you know, you and I both can relate to this. When we used to do clubs and just parties back in the day, we would lug like 4 crates of records, you know, in these milk crates. They were so heavy. And especially if you were lucky enough to have the wood ones that were done, I mean, that's like 100 pounds you're carrying on one crate, you know, and that's usually about maybe, you know, depending on the size of the crate, you're looking at maybe 36 to maybe 50 records, if anything, you know?
A lot. Yeah.
So now moving, how many years forward, we're now in 2020, technology is all on the computer. Now, rather than having 100 songs you bring to a club, you can bring like 10 to 15,000. How do you think this technology has reshaped or reinvented yourself as a DJ?
Well, at first I didn't really support it at first. When I saw it, I was like, oh, you know. But as the years went, it got better. It got really, really better. So, man, I can't really say anything. It was actually such a blessing that, you know, having just a laptop and a couple of records can, you know, it's easy to just kind of like go around the world and handle your thing. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, so I found it really, really cool, you know. Yeah. So I'm still supportive of it. I mean, I'm vinyl guy, but if, you know, vinyl is still to be used, at least, you know, even if it's Serato, I mean, I'm still happy with whatever it's at, you know.
Yeah. Now, one thing I did not know about you, you know, aside from being a DJ, you're also an artist. Like, one of the things I remember last time you and I actually physically saw each other was at a club in San Diego around 2000. I want to say it was like 2008-ish, 8-9-ish. That was the last time you and I, because we DJed a party together. And so since then, I know, man, but you had moved to Spain. So you were in Spain doing your thing, but I had no idea that you were also an artist out in Spain. So you gotta tell me a little bit about that, because I want to hear about this.
So in 2008-9, you know, after we probably had that gig, I got to meet Rome from Sublime, and at that time he wasn't even in Sublime yet, and I was just actually the DJ for a group called Dirty Heads out of Huntington Beach. And when I was with them, actually, when I left them, that same management was like, hey, guys, like we signed Sublime. They're coming back. And this is Rome. And I got to meet Rome. We started up our own label. And we just, you know, we were having fun making all kinds of music. I got into the microphone, started, you know, getting into it, because he was like, yo, you just got to do it, you know. And I was like, why not? You know, I learned a lot from being also part of hanging out with Black Eyed Peas when Bebo was getting done, you know, and I was like always curious about getting on the mic and stuff like that. So, you know, so I did that. When I left, when I was actually in Sublime, I was with Sublime for 3 years. I had a conversation with Rome before I left the band. I was like, hey, brother, I was like, you know, I was thinking about quitting the band and I wanted to kind of like go on with my dreams, you know, because I just didn't want to be the guy to just DJ for a band. And that's where it ends, right? But at least I got to try it. I got to experience it, which was a very, very beautiful thing. And I told him, I go, hey, man, one of this records that I did called Best Party in Town started doing well in Europe. And I thought it was like time to actually move out there and like, man, experience that, you know, a big record out in Europe, living out there in Madrid. And I got to live in Madrid for 5 years.
It's crazy, crazy. And so I actually have a clip of that. I want to show, not that song in particularly, but I have a clip of you in Spain rocking a crowd, but not as a DJ, but as an artist. So I want you to check this out, everybody.
Tonight is your night with your boy Rocky Rock. We don't stop. So get crazy. You ready? Come on. Extra life. VIP session looking extra right. I mean extra bright. Yeah, I'm fly. You know I'm extra nice. 5. Let's get down. 4. Are you ready? 3. I ain't stopping. 2. It's time. 1. One. Break out.
Dude, I just like just the feel. I mean, I miss it. I'm sure everyone out there misses that too. But just the thought of a sea of people, freaking hella bass, and then you have like a lot of the synths and stuff just blaring through the speaker. I mean, like, you got to tell me, what was that like being on that stage, rocking it for a huge crowd like that?
It felt beautiful. Yeah. Reason being is because I'm Filipino, and I know that a lot of the Spaniards took over our country for hundreds of years, and you know, being over there to just share some Filipino love to that country, you know, I kind of want to solidify that we're good people, you know what I'm saying? And that's why I was out there, you know, to spread more Filipino awareness.
Yeah,
let them know what's up and learn my country, learn my people out there. What's up with the peoples out there?
Yeah.
And I got to learn them, man. And that's one thing that I've experienced, you know, that's priceless in my life. And I'm going to continue to do things like that. And so it's beautiful, man. It was awesome.
As for as long as I've known you, you've always been an advocate for like Filipinos, Filipino culture. Like, what is it about that that you feel so connected that you always have to represent?
I was born there, so I know the struggles. Before I moved out to America when I was 3 years old, we were living in Makati, and my grandma had her own restaurant, right? But upstairs was our house. And one day, you know, I was 2 years old, and our house burned down. I mean, our restaurant burned down, my grandma's, so it burned down our house.
Oh man.
And, you know, my mom let me feel that struggle. You know what I'm saying? She always told me throughout my years, you know, growing up with her, you know, like we had a really, really bad life. And, you know, I always kept that in my brain and my heart that, you know, that I have to represent my country regardless all the way till death, you know?
Yeah.
So that's it.
That's crazy. If you guys don't know Rocky Rock, he's definitely a huge advocate for the Filipino community. He's always doing his thing, whether it's DJing, being on stage. He's always repping. So got a big, I mean, right now you're wearing Kuyate gear.
Yeah.
Right now, so,
you know,
I've been trying to reach out. I'm like, yo, you know, like, what's up with the Kuyate stuff, man?
I got you. I gotta follow up on that for you.
There you go. See, you're totally repping. But let's talk about music. So you have a brand new song that's coming out, and I'm excited for this for you because, like what Mark said earlier in his interview, you guys kind of been working together. There's a bunch of stuff coming out. So let's talk about this brand new song.
So yeah, so I just came back last year from, you know, from Europe and Bali. I was living in Bali for a couple of years before I came back to America. And I'm back. I'm like, I want to do music, you know what I'm saying? And this time I wanted to rebrand myself, DJ Rocky Rock, as that DJ guy. And then I wanted to start up another artist, which is like my alter ego, is King Pare. And you know, it's just, it's nothing really like, why are you even saying you're king? No, it's not even that. I probably was one of the guys that spread the Pare love all over the world, because I called people Pare even though they weren't even Filipinos.
Yeah.
And I've always like, you know, let them feel that. So, so you know, and that's why I was kind of like, you know, maybe I should just kind of name that. You know, I always said Pare. People know me in the industry as Pare. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And yeah, I reached out to Mark because I met Mark a couple years ago here at our Fresh Good house in Hollywood. And he was always the guy, like I made a double one day. I didn't really know anybody too much in our label, but I would come fly in, you know, from Spain or like from Bali, and I'd meet some of these guys, you know, and it's a label that I started with Rome. And at that time, Mark was there, and I fed everybody some adobo, you know, and Mark was the one that a lot like stood out of how thankful that guy was. And he was just like, hey man, after the adobo, he was like, yo, let me wash everybody's plate, you know? And I was just like, this is guy, man, that's tight, nice guy. And then, you know, I got to reach out to him again. I didn't really know what Mark was about until like recently, you know what I'm saying? And I actually met Mark through my one of my best buddies, Flick, DJ Flick.
DJ Flick.
And he's a part of our Fresh Goods label. And yeah, man, and he was always like, you know, always bringing up Mark and always telling me. And then, dude, I got to meet Mark in the middle of pandemic, you know, like around June, April, May, June. And man, we just made some music, bro. And I was like, wow, this is so cool. And, you know, that's just one of the songs that, you know, that we have. I've actually been working on the King Pare project for about a year when I was having some eye problems last year. And this year was the year where I actually got my other eye back. And so, yeah, it was on my 40th birthday, bro. It was like the worst thing ever, you know, but I feel like it was like a new beginning as well. You know what I'm saying? And it's just because I was I'm an old dude in the DJ game, man. I got I was like a used car, like breaking down. You know what I'm saying? And you gotta
We're
care
all
of
in that same realm. What you talking about?
Yeah, exactly. That's like a whole different story to itself. You know what I'm saying? So
we heard that track. I mean, the one that I just played was about like 5 years ago. I think that was 2015 or something like that, right? So that was a little bit more club, up tempo, like
EDM-ish. More EDM. Yeah.
So tell me, like, what direction do you feel like you're gonna go for as King Pare, like as an artist? Like, what King is that Pare? Sound?
King Pare is kind of like more of like how I'm influenced by, you know, like I came from hip hop. I mean, I'm just like I really did a lot of my DJ work was here in California and America, all through my life, and that was hip hop. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm just kind of like now adapting to really where I came from. And, you know, I'm keeping it safe too. I'm not really a rapper or anything, but I love the whole process of making music. And, you know, when I'm on stage, I really try to go get it. You know what I'm saying? I ain't gonna be bad out there looking bad.
Yeah. No, you gotta go for it, man.
I go for it. So.
All right. Let's do some quick shouts in the chat. We got DJ B Stang in the building. He's saying it's good. We also got DJ Is Lord in the house. Also to Samantha Viernes is in the house. And then let's see, on the Twitch side, we have West Coast Avenger 1 in the building, and SC Tori is in the house. So shout out to everybody tuning in all over the world. Yo, we're almost at 1,000 people watching on Kumo right now. So
much love
to everybody in the building. So, all right, let me cue up this song really quick. So this is the brand new song. It's called, go ahead and tell everybody the name of the song, Rock.
It's called Lie to Me. And it's, you know, some personal stuff these days.
Yeah.
It's the love you don't feel when you're laying next to me. You could never lie to me.
That's Mark Pelly singing right there.
You could never lie to me. You said,
pick the funk like you acting. I'm moving on, can't live in the past tense. You paste my heart on the back and I'm cool off that. Not trying to do all that, I got your back, I'm a fool for that. So sad when you lie to me. You're always in my head like you try for me. Now I'm focused on my bread, don't cry for me. Another heartbreak story, I kiss goodbye for me.
Can we go back? Can we press rewind? Remember when love, we'll make a grown man cry. Wish I didn't remember the love that we shared together. Maybe
November 5th. So that was just a little sample, because you know how it is in the Philippines. Sample. So we had to drop just a sample of that. Lie to Me comes out November 5th. So just Mark Pelly was just on here before Rocky Rock. So he's singing on the hook. And then Rock is, and this is a rough, right? This isn't fully mastered yet, right? It's in the process. So there you go. So you got an exclusive. Everyone tuning in, all you mixers out there, you just got an exclusive of what's coming with Rocky Rock. It's called Lie to Me right here on Heavy Rotation, Mix Radio on Mix. So, man, you got to tell me, what's your vision? So now that you're doing this, obviously you're still DJing because you're streaming on Kumu. Have you jumped on the Twitch bandwagon yet or not yet?
Nah, not yet. Because I also got an exclusive deal with Kumu. So nice. Sorry to my Twitch peeps.
No, that's all good. You know. Mm-hmm. Gotta do your thing, but you know, you do a lot on, you do a lot for the Filipino community, especially on Kumu as well. So what's the big goal for you? You know, we're in 2020. It's like the new decade right now. See, everyone's blowing you up right now. They're like, oh snap, he said he's not on Twitch anymore.
I know. Oh my god.
So yeah, like, we're in a new decade. You know, you have 10 years until, you know, 2030. You know, what is Rocky Rock gonna be in 10 years from now?
Man, you know what? God only knows that. But I always, you know, I always go with my visions right now are, it's pretty big. You know, at the moment, I'm here helping out Kumu.
Yeah.
So I'm utilizing all the powers that I have to help out, blow up the app. And, you know, I believe in the number one app is Kumu. So I don't know why, you know. So, I hope wherever this is going, I hope that it's history. You know what I'm saying? And other than that, I'm just here to, you know, keep creating music, create cool platforms for our Filipino people in our community, and just keeping it cool, man. Just sharing the love to everybody, you know. And just keeping it alive.
Now, being as an artist or even as a DJ, who, like, you could pick anyone in the world, who would you love to open up or even do a show with?
Man, that's a good one. I would love to do a DJ show with Q-Bert. I've never opened up for Q in my life.
Really?
Yeah, you would think, right? But I never really did anything like that. I was always just kind of like, you know, that's the DJ that's always just kind of like on his own world. And I would love to do something like that, you know? And I'm so happy to have him actually on Kumu. So just between all of us here.
Nice. And then you're part of the crew back in the day, Finger Bangers, I think it was, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Totally.
I remember that. San Jose represent. And
shout out to FB.
Wishbone was in the house just a little bit earlier and he saw you and he said, what's up? But you weren't here yet. So.
Oh. Jeez.
Randy, he's in the house. So, all right, Rocky Rock is in the house. So, okay, so that's a DJ show, but what about as an artist? Like, what artist would you love to open or collaborate
with? Man, I would love to collaborate with everybody. You know what I'm saying? I'm not very picky or anything like that. Man, whatever comes my way, bro, you know, I'm gonna go collab with that. And there's nothing really on my, you know, there's nothing really on my wish list for that. Cause I think it's a little too much at the moment. Cause I'm still like in the process of things, but, man, I just hope, everything that I'm doing is, you know, is good to people's ears. And that's the most important part, you know?
Yeah. Now maybe one last question for you. So thinking about, I mean, obviously you have an ear to what's out there as far as artists and things like that. Who are some artists that we should be looking out for? Filipino artists or any artists?
Man. You should start. Man, I'm a big fan of Mark Pelly, actually, too, man. Like, I started listening to a lot of his stuff. So make sure you guys are stream him and check him out. I'm seeing a lot of. Are you talking about as like talents of today or like people of today? Is that what it is?
And anyone, like any artist that we may not even know about, like who should we be checking out?
Man, that's a good one. So I have a team in Kumu, and I've been kind of like bringing in some cool artists from the app, you know, Filipinos.
Yeah.
This is one girl named Melina that you guys gotta check out.
I know Melina.
And I when I saw her for the first time, I was like, man, this girl is kind of like the Erykah Badu of the PI. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And, yeah.
It's cool, you know, Artstrong. Like I see this guy. Wow, these guys are. I haven't seen these guys in years, and their music is so beautiful when I hear them now. You know, like I was like, wow, I didn't really listen too much until now because I'm older, and you know what I'm saying. So I mean, man, there's so many artists out there that I really love. Check out my girl Abrina. She's really really dope. Check out my boy Mike Swift. You know what I'm saying.
He's coming up next.
He's coming up next. Man, shout out to everybody. Noah Lazarus. Check out Q York, you know. Those guys are always rad. Shout out to my boy DJ Motivate. I don't know. Everybody.
So for everyone tuning in right now, make sure you guys check out DJ Rocky Rock. He has a brand new song out with Mark Pelly called Lie to Me that drops November 5th. What's today? It already dropped then, right? No, not yet.
Actually, you know what? It got held back. So
okay, there you go.
Just keep up. Keep up, guys.
So I was like, hold on.
Yeah. You weren't sure, huh? You were like,
hold on here. And then, so tell everybody where they can find you and how they can, you know, access all your music.
Yeah, for sure. You guys could see me, find me on IG, DJ Rocky Rock. You can find me on Kumu, DJ Rocky Rock, as well as Twitch, too. Facebook, DJ Rocky Rock. So you can stream me everywhere on all platforms, and I'm so happy to be here and having this interview with Mix for the first time.
I appreciate you. And then also tell everyone, when do you stream on Kumu? Because you do your CPI shows. So tell everybody when that happens.
Yeah, so it happens in America. It's Thursday and Fridays. It's from 11 to, today's going to be 11 to 2. So 11 p.m. till 2 a.m. Kind of like, you know, it has that club hour, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
but it makes it 3 p.m. in the Philippines until 6, you know. So, yeah, I'm streaming today. I stream Thursdays and Fridays in America, and in the Philippines, it's like Friday and Saturdays. And then we have CMI happening on Saturday and Sunday on DJ Motivate's channel. But, yeah, it's like it's all the same. It's like all the same program, you know.
Amazing. All right, so my man. DJ Rocky Rock, thank you so much for hanging with us here on Heavy Rotation MX Radio. Appreciate
thank you,
Mara. You, brother.
I appreciate you too, brother.
I'll definitely see you on Kumu and hopefully I can drop a Malacanang for you.
Don't say that. I'm going to think about that all the time. No,
I'm like, oh, man, I got to save up now. All right, everyone stream me and drop me gifts so I can drop Rocky Rock Malacanang.
Come visit anyways, even if you don't have one, bro.
No, I'll come through. You know me.
Even if you have one, even if you have just one halo halo, I'm good with it.
There you go. All right, Rocky Rock, thank you guys so much. We're going to be talking again soon. I'll see you on Kumu. And then for everyone else tuning in, Mike Swift, he is in the building. He's coming up next, y'all. All right, Rock, I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. Much love, guys.
Oh man, this time next week, you got to be here for Collective Hustle's website launch party. If you guys didn't see who is in that lineup, I could just give you briefly who's going to be there. Let's just start off with Nadine, Kiana V, Gabe Bondoc, Jeremy Passion. Oh man, there's so many artists that is going to be Guapdad 4000. They're all going to be in the house. Go to the website, collectivehustle.com, and you get to check out who is going to be there. Plus, if you RSVP and you're one of the 50, you get a free KH shirt. So do that right now, everybody. So, all right. We'll talk about that more a little bit later. But my next guest in the house, he pretty much doesn't really need an introduction, but he is in the building, and he's feeling himself. My man Mike Swift is in the house. What's up, brother?
Feeling myself.
Like, yay! What is
everything? I mean, my mic is proper.
There's just a little bit delay. I'm assuming it's because of Wi-Fi and things like that. But I can hear a delay in you just a little bit.
You can hear me.
I can hear you. Let's turn up your volume just a little bit more, so then we can hear you a little bit louder.
Maybe I need to just bring this closer. Yeah.
Well. Oh, there you go. That's a lot better. Mike Swift is in the house. If you guys don't know Mike Swift, I mean, he is not only just a dope MC out of the Philippines, but he's also a philanthropist. I mean, he does a lot of work in the Philippines, and I'm excited to talk to you a little bit more about that. But I think a good place to start with you is let's just talk about the career of rapping. Because last time you and I talked, the first time I ever saw Mike Swift was back in 2007. That's a long time ago. I mean, it seems like it's, you know, but that's been a long time. So talk about how you got your start and, you know, what inspired you to just start writing bars and performing and making music?
I think I was around a lot of rappers, like really, really rappers from Brooklyn, so a couple of them had put out records. Like, I'm talking about close friends, best friends. I have a friend named Yeshua the Poe and Saya and Boogaloo. They have a group named Really Foolish, and I was around guys like them who are inspired by New York City hip hop. Yeah. So when I say guys are like good rappers and they have records, like Bobito Garcia had put out their records during the time when, you know, he was putting out Company Flow, you know, just that era of vinyl, the golden age, as they say, era of hip hop. So in New York City, which is many say and consider the mecca of hip hop, it's just all around. So rapping is just like a natural thing, I guess, that you can fall in love with, even just messing around. But having to put out records, that's a whole different story. That's about that I fell into and fell in love with because my close friends are in it and I was inspired by them a lot. And deep inside, I enjoyed rapping. And I never, like, I started out as a record label owner at a young age because I wanted to be part of this fun culture.
Yeah.
So I would just rap in the showers. I would just rap in my karaoke machine with the cassettes and just, you know, messing around. I fell in love with rapping when I gained a lot more confidence when I rolled out into a tour 2000, 2021 with my group as a record label owner. So I rolled out with a group and watching them perform and seeing that you can make a living doing music even when you're a nobody, when you're like, I mean, underground, no designs on a white label vinyl. And the process of getting that vinyl into product placed in stores across the world is something that I've experienced before I even experienced being a rapper on stage. So I guess gradually, seeing that the artists that I was dealing with, which are my best friends, was not as hungry as I was to be part of this music culture that I attained and kind of soaked up the skills and the things that I like from the people that I went and toured with and put it into myself.
Yeah. And
that skill gradually with confidence. I say with confidence because at the beginning of it, you have to suck. You had to suck somewhere. And at the beginning, I would say I didn't think I was as confident as I am now as a rapper.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
As far as a career, just loving that and finding ways to eat off that, no matter what it was, that's proof of really loving that because, you know, even without that, I would just wrap my ass off.
Yeah. Now, as a hip-hop artist, I mean, obviously, you know, in the Philippines, a lot of the hip-hop there is known as OPM hip-hop. How do you describe, I guess, the type of hip-hop that you do?
You know, those are just labels. Those are just tags to put you, to cage you so they can tax you. Like, there shouldn't be no rule and like, label me here, label me that, label me all, label me do. It's like, nah, man. You could just, anybody that has a voice can ride on a trap beat or a boom bap beat or a old school, anything. I perform and rap over acoustic. I'll do that. So I think, you know, those, like, just caging names is like something that I stay away from because I wouldn't want mine to be labeled one way.
Yeah.
I've done rapping for theater, rapping for Nike, right? Rapping in a concert with an orchestra behind. Like all kinds of different ways that you can approach. All I know is I will write some lyrics and rap my ass off of anything that has rhythm.
Yeah.
So the way I make music is I imagine what the situation and what I want to express out of it. If I want to talk about taking a shit, I'll do a whole damn album about it. I want to go, you know what I mean? It's just like no limit to me. So I guess hard for myself to define the kind of hip-hop I represent.
Now, what about your sound? How would you describe your sound? For someone who may not know you as an artist of, you know, just discovering you for the first time, like, how would you explain what your sound is to them? Because, you know, I mean, like, in the hip-hop world, there's trap, there's...
It's a while to find that. So, like, you know, because I have to deal with demons that deal with being like in the industry or being like by the industry, being deleted by the industry, and then the demons that pull you into like shit, you know. I've seen a lot of people that was believed by the industry that's no longer here. And I'm nobody believed in me, and I'm still fucking here.
Yeah.
Sorry, man.
You're good.
So anyhow, you know, so being an underground, like, you know, knowing how to survive in the underground and being able do that in all the years, like you said, you've seen me in 1997.
Yeah.
Heck, would you survive during a time when it's not big in the Philippines? Only a few are signed, and if you're signed, it don't mean you're getting paid either. There's no, and I'm in the Philippines, so we in peso mode, and I kind of got around and made it by creating products like DVDs, t-shirts, ID laces, notebooks, you know, all, anything I could think of that can be a product and then that can also spread whatever I was doing. That allowed me to survive, and that was like finding myself, who I am and what my sound is. I have to balance keeping the respect in the hood and then also see if I could be embraced by the industry. Yeah. And I just heard that last week. So it's perfect time to take Bloomer. So in my Spotify, if people have noticed in the last 3 months, I've uploaded probably 22 new songs. And I think there they'll find it. I can't define what my sound is, but I think the best way to define it is honesty.
Yeah.
That's what you're going to get out of me. Because that's the message I'm going to put, and that's the feel that I'm giving with these new songs that I'm doing. It's just me being honest and me being more calm than being. Yeah, I recorded a lot of music, and a lot of them I never released. I'm talking about hundreds.
Yeah.
Thousands.
I know. I was on a stream with you, and you were playing me a whole bunch of cuts that you never put out. So, I mean, I can imagine what your library looks like.
Yeah, so, like, and there's vibes that I deal with the different producers that are, it's for me to explain and find, let's say, this guy's on the side. Let's do a whole album with this kid. Oh, this guy wants to see the New York one. All right, get to this after hanging on top of the hype of it. My forehead strapped on right for him in this life. Whoever want to take away my title, wrote the pieces out the paper from the Bible and spoke. It's the Holy Ghost, right? It made me say what I wrote. Tidal wave in the ocean, called my name in the oak. For the sake of not being broke, I'm robbing your folks. Cop back the 4/5 of the ball from Coach. How I feel when I smoke this down to the roach. Download through the fire while you show you I'm a rider. If you do to YouTube, YouTube can do who to truth do. Who can prove to you I'm not a liar. I'm a ultimate writer. Admit it, it's true. My script for the dream can't. Look in the mirror, make it through this bullshit and loop. When I stare at myself, I say, I wish I was you.
Mike, you know, Smith.
I don't want to give him the Brooklyn. I don't want to give him the Brooklyn. I can't give the Brooklyn when I'm in the Philippines. Nobody will fucking understand me but 5 people in the whole country.
Yeah.
So I had to adjust and learn how the hell would people understand me. First, I had to be good at Tagalog because I'm a Brooklyn guy. I came there. I just came back. In 2004. Oh, you see me 2007. I thought 97. That's a baby in New York.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So 2004 is when I first touched down in the Philippines because of crisis. So since then, I had to really learn how to. It's different because in the Philippines, you have to learn to perform in the malls.
Yeah. And
nobody's gonna go comprehend and nobody's gonna wanna see you again. Birthday parties, graduations, fiestas, mayor's office, like shit. They throw you in all kinds of places to perform. So you get to home and adjust. You can adjust and be up down, throw me in a stage in the middle of the Bay Area and throw me in a stage in the middle of Brooklyn, New York, whether it's a Tagalog crowd or a crowd from representing the real hip hop in their hood, I better have my whole catalog complete to at least entertain those and not be moved off stage. And you know, that's why I'm a late bloomer. I had to do 3 childhoods to get.
That's crazy. So I want to ask you this question because a lot of people always ask me this too, but what would you say is the difference between the Filipino music scene in the Philippines and here in the States?
What's up? Say that again.
What do you think is the difference between the Filipino music scene in the Philippines compared to how it is here in the States? Is there even a difference?
One major difference is the amount of money you can earn as a hip-hop star in America and the amount of money you can earn as a hip-hop star in the Philippines. That's like an ocean to a tiny rotten pond. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Ocean in the US, the dollars is crazy. You know, one earring of 50 Cent is a whole career of every rapper in the Philippines for the last decade.
Wow.
That's what I'm saying. Like, Dave, it's really like a big, big, giant gap difference, like a platinum selling rap artist in the Philippines ain't shit in America. A nobody in America that sells a lot independently is way richer than a platinum selling artist in the Philippines. So I think that's number one.
Yeah.
But as far as the music, the learning, the culture, the people, the amount that support it in numbers, we have a lot. And it's just really starting to turn into something that you can say can be a career. You know what I mean? So people that pay dues, that made it into the next era of noise, because there was a part where there was a shift. And I'm just happy and glad that I got to jump on that way, the next way. You know what I'm saying?
So
being a Puya and what's coming up into the next way, instead of being like grandpa, like Rocky Rock, I love you. Rocky Rock, he knows. I wrote that with him on his days, the days he's talking about representing his in the Philippines running around.
There you go. Mike Swift is in the house. All right, let's talk about your philanthropy a little bit, because not only are you an artist, not only are you an MC, but you've given so much back to the PI. But I want to play this clip that you sent me, and then we'll talk about like some of the projects that you've been doing in the Philippines. So everyone, check this out.
Walang mawawala sa mabuti na hangad. Hindi lahat ng biyaya dumadating agad. Sa huli ang talo napunta sa tamad. Bakit ko alam? Nakausap ko si God. Kaya ako ay nagsipag magambag. Halos-halos makaahon ng Pinas at ang bayan makaraos. Gising sa hilamos, idea na maayos. Ang rason na isip ko mangolekta ng sapatos. Gusto nyo magpunta kami dyan? Biglang magpinta, ipon ka sa inyo ng kahon. Kahit iisa, para maipasok siya sa akin. Vanad mapuno, sambagsakan kong ilalapag ito isang buo. Biktima ng sunog na sa court na natutulog. Nadaanan ng bagyo, katamay mo ako. Ilang taon bago nakita itong kumalat sa suporta at tiwala. Gusto kong magpasalamat. Pwede niyong ipasa yung sira-sira at luma. Adidas na katuna, yung Nike na maliit na nakuha mo na mura. Reebok man o Puma, donate nyo na lang aming kinukuha. The new ones are cool, but here is the fun part. Nothing goes to waste, the garbage turned to junk art. For example, what have you? Sculptures of statues, it's Machu, it's Cashew. Manny, just ask who? Top of the clouds, looking higher to my pops who is proud. With Maya, fly through the crowd. Represent for the tenement whose fire is loud. Eagle's eye to the ground, focus, try to be down. Mga lumang nilinis, mas bago pa sa bago. Sa kulay ng liwanag ng ngiti ng bawat taong nakatanggap ng sapatos. Meron din damit, kung may kalat kayo dyan, pwede niyong dalhin. Walang persahan, walang pilitan, walang deadline. Nakaiinisan, walang bayad sa huli. Magsisisi ka, walang bahid na dumi ng politika. Sa pera may gera, halos magkapatayan. Ba't di na lang tayo magtanim ng halaman? Action kailangan, all talk wala yan. Ito na ang van ng manok ng bayan. Samahan nyo ako mag-isipan ng diskarte. Yung tipong merong sense, kabahagi ka ng parte. Darating ang araw, meron tayong nabigyan. Lumipad sa mataas, ang pangalan pakinggan. Saka na lang tumigil, huwag kang huminto. Pagsuot na medal sa liig, kulay ginto. Sama-sama, salo-salo, huwag kang liliko. Bangon kapag natalo, walang mabibigo.
These are unused, are not being used by me, my wife, my kids, and we decided to give it out to others so that they could use it. They need to use it.
Thank you so much for this.
Gotta big up Mike Swift for that. And if you guys loved what you guys saw, go ahead and drop some gifts for my man Mike Swift. And even before that, so there's three things we always say Filipinos love. One, they love music and they love to entertain. Two, they love food. But three, they love basketball. And so, you know, there's a huge connection with what you're doing. So briefly talk about this project. It's even more than just a project. I think this is more of like a calling for you. So let's talk about how you got started into it and why, and what is it about this that is so important to you?
First of all, like growing up, before rapping was even thought of to be a career or even be part of my dreams, basketball was my first. So, you know, at a young age, like I said, Filipinos, man, they love their basketballs. And it's no different from my family, so it's handed down to me. But the only different thing, I guess, that I experienced is at a young age before experiencing my first official liga here in the Philippines, I was taken by my mother and brought to Brooklyn at second grade, and I never experienced it. And I started continuing my passion for basketball learning from the New York side.
Nice.
So going back to the Philippines, the passion never left. It was a way for me to make friends. If anything, it was half of my network and half of the reasons why I got to advance in the rap career is because of the friends I made in the basketball courts.
Yeah.
So I continue that, and for many years, the dream, I've always been like a fan. I'm like a basketball groupie. I always, like, I'm a wannabe professional basketball player. I would at least imagine how they would live. And seeing how the relationship between hip-hop and basketball is, you know, you can always see them together, like even in the NBA, and you see rappers are friends with ballers. I said, oh man, it's possible for me to still be part of this culture. And Bobito Garcia is a big inspiration to what I do, because what he did for Puerto Rico, I said, why I can do this for the Philippines from a basketball and hip hop standpoint. So I was like, you know what? I never looked at basketball as going to be my career. I looked at it as a place for my inner peace, escapism, happiness. Just a place where, you know, I forget everything. And I guess my luck or my karma, like you said, my calling, might have been that, because failing over and over and over with hip hop and being a rapper and trying to earn money there, after losing so much from investing in a concert in Araneta Coliseum, I lost so much money that I had no taste for hip hop no more. That all I did was do the things that I like from hip hop, which is away from make songs, which is how I got my thousands of songs, like I said. And then I bought a saxophone and I did nothing but take pictures of basketball courts throughout the country. Hence, I put it in an Instagram called Pinoy Hoops and keep it a secret for over a year. And then I get discovered by Nike. And then I bring Tendermint along.
Yep.
And LeBron comes in there. Long story short, bang, bang, boom, boom. The arts, the music, the love for it, outside the industry, outside wanting to be someone else, landed me all that I became, why I'm still here talking to y'all and still loving what I do.
Yeah. It's amazing. And so if you guys don't know what Mike Swift has done, I mean, like, because of this passion and everything that he's been doing, I mean, he was able to bring LeBron James to the Tendermint. He's been able to bring Kobe, Jordan Clarkson, you know, so like some amazing basketball players have touched foot on Tendermint because of some of the work that Mike Swift has done. And then, you know, recently, of course, with Kobe's passing, Tendermint got in the news because of the mural that you guys did of Kobe and Gigi on the court. I mean, I didn't have that queued up because I didn't really want to spend too much time on it. But I mean, that's just to show you the effect or the impact that, you know, the work that you've done and the community there, you know, what it really means to the world, you know, as a whole. And so that's also a stem of what you're currently doing. Like, you're painting basketball courts around the country. So talk to us a little bit about that.
Because I've been doing this for a long time, being involved with basketball communities and helping uplift it, and painting is one of the ways for me to do that, and organizing events is one of the ways for me to do that, I just continued along because I thought leaning on that was the way for me to get my music to the people's ears and directly.
Yeah.
So I didn't care if it was little by little, and that's what I did for a long time. And then, you know, as karma would state, here comes a paint company knocking, saying, Mike, you doing this? What are you doing? We like what you're doing. Come here and paint, use our paint. And I'm like, oh my God, thank God, because I've been looking for y'all for like 4 years and more. I mean, just trying to get paint out for the tenement and beyond. I've been looking for y'all. And all I do now and all I did, the secret of how I started getting them, I finally figured it out. And all I did was not chase nobody for nothing and just keep on throwing it in songs, imagining as it happened already. You know, like Jay-Z. Jay-Z did that with Reasonable Doubt. He did that with the Black. He ain't do it yet. He ain't filmed Madison Square Garden yet before he started rapping about it. He rapped about it first, then filled it up. I'm like, I'm going to do the same strategy. And it works, my guy.
It works.
So I'm hitting 1,000 chords with Nippon as an ambassador for Nippon Paint. That's one of the blessings. And the blessing is I get to help whoever I want. It doesn't have to be basketball courts as long as it's helping communities. Yeah, request for all the paint that I want, feel free to give back. And that's a beautiful thing. That's like, what? I got the blessing to give, man, and colors, color things that are dope. So that's one that I'm painting 1,000 courts. I'm up to 99. I'm going to paint Kumu. Did you guys see my Kumu court? You guys?
No, I didn't see the Kumu court.
Right now it's buzzing all over because I just did it yesterday. So the Kumu peoples are like all sharing it. Because I'm going to be in Kumu for 12 hours straight on my birthday, 2 days.
Yep.
So I'm prepping for that. I'm up to 99. I wanted to put that. I'm up to 99. I'm going to paint that in a week. I'm going to paint Jay-Z like a big. I was going to keep it a secret and just let it blast it out, but I'm going to paint Jay-Z like a big. Full court of Jay-Z, and it's going to say 99 problems, but a court ain't one. Hey,
nice. Hey. All right, Mike Swiss is in the house, and let's talk about music. So you dropped something just the other day, right? And so I want to play this really quick, and let's talk about it right after. Check this out, you guys.
At this time, all residents should seek a fallout shelter. This is not a test. The emergency alert system has been activated.
So that joint is now available, correct? So tell everyone about this brand new song that you got.
That one is titled Broadcast. It's produced by Clumsy. Clumsy is the guy behind the hit songs of Shanti Dope. And the new hits that Black Nine also is working with. So these are just songs that I have in the stash that are just finally found its way out to save.
Yeah.
So I out there just for a little buzz, I guess. You know what I mean? Showing that I got plenty more to come back.
And then where can people find that song? Is it on Spotify and all the streaming platforms right now, or
platforms? Just go there. It's gonna be everywhere.
Amazing. So if you guys don't know, Mike Swift also has an album coming out, and so let's show this flyer right here. So he has his birthday bash, but it's also a combination of his Hammock Trip album release party. That's November 9th. So I mean you know, he only has a few guests on here. He only has Ruby, only Looney. I can read down this whole entire list, but he has Apex in there as well. So he has some amazing hip-hop artists that are on this bill. So let's talk about the album. Tell me about Hammock really quick.
Hammock Trip is just a compilation of songs that is inspired by my travels with my hammock. Everywhere I paint, I take my hammock with me. And sometimes it takes days to finish a painting, and it's me relaxed by a beach, by a mountainside, by... So it's way relaxed and mature in that way. It's buzzed, it's smoked out, it's drunk, you know what I'm saying? It's produced by Ian Gustavo, and only one song is produced by Jim P featuring Ron Henley. So that's something cool to look out for.
Look at you, you're still doing work. You're supposed to be relaxing and resting while you're doing these paint jobs, but instead you're writing and you're creating songs. So off this album, how many tracks is on the album, and what would you say is, you know, your most favorite track?
It's 13 tracks. I like the very first track because they're not going to guess. They're not going to think it's me. So it kind of sets the tone for the whole album. And then I like Mountain High. I got finally I have a song with Ron Henley, which to me is one of the best hip hop songwriters of all time in the Philippines. And I finally get to work with him. It's a collaboration.
That's amazing. All right. So I know we were going to talk about this a little bit earlier, but could you do a quick sample of, you know, one of the songs off your album?
Oh, you know what? I'm scared that if I take you off this, I won't be able to come back in the stream. I don't know.
Just do acapella. Do acapella.
How about I just drop one of these cookies for you?
Okay. There you go.
All right, my guy. Calendario sa patungo, English or Tagalog? I don't know. You pick, man. What are you feeling today?
Honestly, because I've been so much more exposed to the Philippines because of Kumu, I've grown I love when Filipino artists trickle in some Tagalog in their music, even because I can't understand it as much, but I mean, I can't understand reggae either. So it's kind of like, I love hearing Tagalog in songs. So if you can flip both, go ahead, dude.
Oh, okay. So I just took a freestyle for you. What's that, man? I just do some.
So while you're doing that, let me shout out some folks really quick here on the Kumu side. Let's shout out to Jay Stash. Thank you for the sharing the stream. Also to Shira. We got Thor Zaid, I think that is. BZ's in the house. What's up, BZ? Also to PC. I don't know how to say that, but K Brushes is in the house. Tyrone 43, Yen Yen Montejo is in the house. And let's do one more. My man DJ Ever Ready is in the building. Oh, Biggie to the X is in the building as well. So shout out. And then Shira 0002654. What is up to y'all out there? So all right, my man Mike Swift, what you got for me, bro?
Okay, I sprinkle it with some English. I sprinkle it with some Tagalog. I know some of my folks, they want to hear this from me, so I might as well give it to them, you know what I mean? This is just me going through the year just like everyone else. Hey. Kahapon na ngayon, bilis ng panahon. It's so fast. But I'm in Batangas, so whoever's here. What up? Kahapon na ngayon, bilis ng panahon, wala nagkaroon, bago ng taon, iba't iba ang uso, hapit na pantalon, mag-araw na ng puso, ang pana ay baon, hindi ako nag-aral, bawal ang sumuko, ang internet mabagal, nag-aalboruto, bigla na lang uminit, tayo maglangoy, gawa tayo ng bonfire, malaking apoy. Punta ka sa gubat at sa bundok. Igupin mo ang ula pag nabot mo ang tuktok. Sa araw na ito, loko din kita. Bakit ka nandito? Sino nag-imbita? Dami ng pagkain na kahain sa mesa. Mas maingay pa kami sa perya, sa fiesta. Grabe sa pagod, tara magpahinga. At huwag makalimutan, pasalamat sa ama. Tapos na ang umaga, finish your breakfast. May pasang tanghali, have your lunch. Sa oras ng hapunan, eat your dinner, kung ano ang buwan. Hey! Tapos na ang umaga, lumipas ang tanghali. Sa oras ng hapunan, dumungaw na ang buwan. Umpisa ng pasok, tapos ang bakasyon. Hanap ka laya, ng tanging ambisyon. Pasok ka sa bahay, iwas sa ampon. Pag-iyak ng ulap, may halong emosyon. Respeto ko sa iyo at sa iyong relihiyon. Dahil sa sakripisyo na sa langit yan ngayon. Huwag mong pilitin kung ayaw sumabay. Tayo ay buhay sa araw ng patay. Pakinggan mo ang musika. Kalat mga tao, tangay na sa isip kung magkano pang regalo. Oras na isulat mo ang gustong pagbabago. Ipaglaban ng mangyari, matupad ang mga plano. Tapos na ang umaga, lumipas ang tanghali. Sa oras ng hapunan. Hey!
Yay!
I said, what? Tapos na. Finished in the morning. Had lunch at lunchtime. You had your dinner yet? Ah, dumungaw na ang buwan. Enero, Febrero, Marzo, Abril, Mayo, Junio, Julio, Agosto, Septiembre, Octubre, Noviembre, Diciembre, Siempre, lahat tayo, swerte, feeling so lucky, I'm chilling with you, you can check me out, in Kumu, in YouTube, true, 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 grab the microphone, or do me, you do you, this is off the top for people around the globe, this is me, and you know that it's dope, I got that flow, higher than a reservoir, grab the microphone, I never needed no A&R, this is me, chilling in Kumu, this is me and Mix Global, I'm local, internationally known, one day, this me, taking off from the runway, some say Monday to Sunday, November 9th is coming, so away from you, I'm not running, I'm bringing in the sound, I can't define, and this is me, of the mind, I love to rhyme, and this is why I haven't hit my prime yet. And I know this is designed back to rent. When I grab the mic, this is me. I love it. I love it. I love it. Nero, Febrero, Marzo, Abril, Mayo, Junio, Julio, Agosto, September, October, November, December. Remember, Merry Christmas and Happy Motherfucking New Year to everybody. Much love and blessings to everybody that supported throughout the years. We still here. We still kicking ass. And Mix Global said, for me not to be humble, they said, be cocky, be arrogant, away from humility, scream out loud. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, man, Mike Swift is in the house. Let's throw up a round of applause.
Just to make sure I put a smile on your face.
No, you killed it, man. Like, everyone here is already, they're throwing you much love, bro. Even, like, Thor, I can't even say that, bro, but it's Thor. He was saying, like, your audio is a little unclear. However, despite the audio issues, you killed every single rhyme off it. So, you killed it.
See, nice. Part of Thor's career is having these, ever since CDs, jumping and... You better be used to having some audio issues.
Yep. I could totally relate, man. Even DJ-wise, same thing. I mean, like, I don't know if I told you, like, you heard, like, when Rocky Rock was on, my computer just blew up. And so it shut down everything. And so, it ended up, I was able to get back on. But still, it was just like, you go into panic mode. And you're like, well, you just gotta pivot.
And even though it's virtually, it's the same pressure as if, yo, I gotta be there. I gotta make sure I'm on, I'm connected. You know what I'm saying? I gotta look, make sure I got no booger on my nose when I get on that. The whole world watching me with a booger there. You know what I'm saying? So you gotta really prepare. And the nerve is still there. You can still get nervous off performing virtually, actually. So.
Yeah, straight up. Even like for me, like sometimes I still get like butterflies before I get on here, you know. So I gotta big up my man Mike Swift. Like I said, I've known Mike since like 2007, but this is because of Kumu, the first time we've been able to finally like connect, sit down. Like he jumped into one of my streams, he freestyled, he did everything, and then since then, you know, we've been like buddies on this app. So it's been good like hanging out with you. And so for everyone out there, you gotta check out his birthday party bash and his album release party November 9th. Go check this out. It's gonna be amazing. My man DJ Buddha is gonna be there. Ruby is gonna be there. Looney, Apex. You see them all on Kumu, and they're gonna be in the house with Mike Swift celebrating for our guy here. So make sure you guys follow him wherever you know you guys are. If you are on Kumu, follow him there. If you're on YouTube, follow him there. If you're on IG, he's all over the place. So make sure you guys follow my man.
To remind everybody, not everybody on that list, not everybody has performed in Kumu yet. Some of them is going to be their first time performing in Kumu, so that should be exciting, like Omar Balil, Omar B, and Nick Makino, like, and many more, so I got surprised. Yeah.
And so, before I let you go, one thing that impressed me that I didn't even know until I did some more research on you, you actually did a TED Talk. And you did a TED Talk in a sense like, you know, you told everyone, I'm not a speaker, but I can rap and I'm an MC, and you did your whole entire talk as a rhyme. So I want to get us out of here with that whole entire clip of that, but I want you to tell everyone a little bit what was important about being on this TED Talk that you said, yo, I gotta get up there and talk.
Well, I got invited, and I'm not gonna say no. But first of all, people get screened. I guess I got screened. Like, hey, we're interested in possibly having you do a TED Talk. So, you know, I guess they approved of it, and they give you the topic. They give you the number of minutes that you're allowed or that you have up there. And so, you know, I took on the challenge. But the challenge there is, how will I stand out from all the other TED Talks that many had gave in the past?
Yeah.
I chose to do it last minute into rhyme mode because I think I have more balls to say things when I'm rapping and rhyming. And to try to remember something that you prepared word for word or whatever it is that I was preparing to say there. It's just a nerve-wracking thing because it's not like it's a crowd that is filtered to be all different from all walks of life. So it's not like it's a crowd, a basketball crowd. It's random people that passed their, like, thousands passed to be a guest, to be in the crowd, and those that made it. So it's really nerve-wracking. So for me to get it across and deliver it that way, I'm proud that I was able to explain what the hell I was doing in the TED.
But the cool thing about that, I mean, that's just another weapon in your, or a tool in your tool case, you know? I mean, so MC, philanthropist, public speaker. So, you can totally take this, like, in a whole different direction now. You know, I'm just putting in your ear, man. You can do a little bit more.
Man, I need these life coaches around me, man. I guess, I don't know. I guess I'm still steered the right way because peer pressure got me this far.
There you go. All right, my man, Mike Swift, go ahead and do some last minute shouts. And then I want you to say a message to all our mixers and all your fans watching you from all around the world.
Simple message. Plant more trees, fruits, vegetables. Be kind to your neighbor. The heck with everything else. You know what I mean? Believe in God and always listen to Mike Swift, especially on Spotify. Now.
Well, man, Mike Swift in the house. Thank you again so much, brother. So here we go. Let's take us out of here with your clip from your TED Talk. Let me just find it here really quick because, like I said, my computer blew up. So everything kind of.
Because that should have a million. No, I shouldn't see. She said.
Here it is right here. Okay. I think, oh no, yeah, this is the one right here. All right, so here we go. We're going to take you guys out with this TED Talk by Mike Swift. Mike, my brother, thank you again, man. I will see you hopefully on your birthday bash. I'm going to try to make it out. That's November 9th. If not, I'll definitely see you on Kumu. Definitely hang out and come and support you, bro.
Thank you.
All right, man. Mike Swift, I'll talk to you soon. Everyone else, here you go. Watch this. Mike Swift on a TED Talk.
Gabi, bago matulog, lagi ko siyang iniisip.
Bakit ko ba siya ginagawa?
Ano bang mapapala ko dito?
Aba, madami.
Napakarami!
Dahil dito, marami akong naging kaibigan.
Dahil dito, ako ay malusog at malakas.
Ang importante sa lahat, dito ako masaya.
Para sa pasaway ng katulad ko.
Para sa mga bayaning katulad mo.
Na nagbigay gilas sa Pilipinas.
pa magtagumpay.
Ito ang araw na nakilala mo ako.
Just like Vin, I'm not really a good, much of a dancer. But, at first, all I wanted to be was a rapper. The title I was after. Camaraderie, the laughter, the memories, the chapters, money was never a factor. I got roots in Brooklyn. There, even brighter futures can look dim. There, I got family and lots of friends. Catches rocking Nikes or rocking Timbs. Smoke weed and we played some ball. Fly high, ain't afraid to fall. Then I met Francis M. Became friends with Andrew E. Time like now, reminiscing when they thought I was crazy and they laughed at me. Long story short, I came from New York. Invested my money from work of all sorts. I worked in a titty club, a strip club scores. Sold something you can smoke or something you can snort. Had no choice. I picked my poison and what I chose still fucks with my emotions. Hear my voice float all across the ocean. Make some noise till the mirror's broken. That's my luck. I lost lots of money and I feel I'm stuck. Always in a hurry to fill that up. Araneta dreams, Araneta dreams, y'all. Araneta dreams, Araneta dreams, y'all. Araneta dreams. You know, when I first walked in, my man Vin, that's my lawyer also. What's up, Vin? He said, Mike, are you going to freestyle your performance? Then I got confused because he's the second person that asked me that. Like, are you going to freestyle rap? I was like, you know, I have something planned, but I rap better. Maybe if I freestyle, I'll do a better job. So here I am, freestyling instead of using what I wrote. You know what I'm saying? But only because I spent a lot of time in the rap industry, the hip-hop culture. For over 20 years, I've been swimming in this, giving it all my best. That it led me to believing that Pinoy hip-hop, our own community, can fill up Araneta Coliseum by ourselves, without needing the Snoop Dogs or the international artists that, you know. But long story short, in this kind of long story short kind of day, you know, I invested my money, I lost it, I was sad, I was depressed, and everything that came along with it, isolation, blah, 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 you know. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, y'all. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. I was broke listening to Wu-Tang, thinking how I can pay back my Wu-Tang. I was sad. I was depressed. Taking pictures, I was obsessed. Let me tell you, continue on, how I ended up inside the tenement bringing LeBron. Who got Instagram here? Who knows about Instagram? Yeah? All right, so I did this Instagram called Pinoy Hoops. They didn't know it was me. That was the time I was like running away from everything, you know? And I felt like that was the place I got my inner peace. So all I did was take pictures, wrote poetry underneath, uploaded it. Even people that didn't agree with me with the hip-hop scene, that didn't like me much, they was following it, not knowing it was me and praising me and everything. I was like, damn, they're going to kick themselves in the butt they find out, no? But, you know, but it was cool. Like, Nike, somebody there discovered this page, and they was like, you know, we can use you. We can use you for this commercial, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, forget that picture, because taking a picture of me, they won't like it. But a picture of Hoops, the whole world's excited. Nike Global, they were delighted. Spark that I lost got me reignited. Couldn't believe it was destiny that guided. Wasn't just the images. It was the poetry inside it. Nike House of Rise, that was like my crib. My baby, my kid. Crazy. And if you really want to analyze, in the internet, there's a lot of lies. But here is living proof. You can get something big out of giving truth. That there is on a tree. Another one probably is on the gate. See? Rest in peace. Memories broken down. Memories inside the pearly gates. Every single court I treated like a person. Each single one had their own little characters. All through New York or anywhere urban. I know for a fact it's not like this in America. Hell no. You don't just put basketball courts up on the streets. You know what I'm saying? You don't play with nothing on your feet. How you gonna play in public with boxers on? In courts shapes like triangles, squares, octagons. You know how far for the sport I love has gone? Manny Pacquiao was a boxer, son. And he made it pro, like, you know what I'm saying? That's how much he loved the sport, and that's how much we love the sport. And you know what? I'm not against him for doing that. You know, he was going after a dream, even though he had the world already. That was his secret big dream. I probably would have done the same thing, but I'll shoot better than that, though. You know? And let's hope that he doesn't believe that he can be a professional president. And this, no, let's go outside that. But you know what made them instant fans and made me some cool fans is when I got featured in Instagram. Over 100,000 likes. Oh my God, something I didn't plan. Something nobody can bite. Way better than a broken piggy bank. Because here I am inside a plane business class on my way to Spain rapping Pinas. And for this trip, I got paid. Front row seats of history made. And it's all because of love and passion. I wasn't judged for my talk. I was loved for my actions. And that's how I probably got to the gig. LeBron James out of this league. Also, you all saw another all-star. Holy shit, yup, that was Paul George. And if you know about the tenement, why it's still so relevant, how it is, I'm telling it. Foul stuff, I smell, the government is selling it. And good people, they live there. They about to get evicted, but they ain't going nowhere. I'm glad that we did this. Picnic Games, brand new event. Can't believe so many people went. Artistas, rockers, singers, rappers, dancers, writers, bloggers, fighters, basketball, fashion, barbecue, graffiti. This place looked like New York City. All of a sudden, we caught their attention. I became a tour guide. There I would send them. Beautiful timing, perfect momentum. Now it's becoming like a tourist spot. I represent them. And if you was from the tenement, you would know it'd be evident that the mayor or the president gives a shit about the freaking tenement. But you know, but I'm glad I was able to bridge that. I was able to bring Mayor Lanny Cayetano or attract them to come to the tenement. And I thought that was important for the people of the tenement because they've been trying to reach out and say their piece. Me, I wanted to be outside politics because I just saw this one beautiful court that reminded me of New York City, of Brooklyn. You know, half of my life I spent there. So being there, being next to a basketball court that I could relate to because it seemed like everybody disregarded. And that's how I felt in the hip-hop community. For all the good work I've done for many years, you know, it's like I was so sad about not being able to fill up Arrieta Coliseum. And I can't believe that all these things are happening. So I can't even pinpoint to you how LeBron James really made it to the tenement. But maybe the title should be how LeBron James brought the mayor to the tenement. You know what I'm saying? But I made peace with the people of the tenement. And because of that, like, I really fight for them. They're good people. They became my friends. They were there at my time of need. So I have a special connection with them. And I want to make sure I want to be one of the positive bridges that can, you know, articulate and communicate better so everyone will be on, you know, get on their feet on the better side of things. Well, anyway, you know, so basically, I have an event called Picnic Games. That's probably one of the big chunk of energy, good energy, that probably, you know, had all these guys wanted to come down because I had, like, Pigalle from France. I had even the locals, Mikael Dias, Kiefer Ravena, Salvakuta, JR. It's just so many people passing by and they never seen nothing like that. And it was the energy of this one event that Nike helped me put together by giving me these boxes of sneakers to give away. And I was like, you know what? They're getting evicted last year. This was last year. They're getting evicted in a month. I'm going to bring fun to your place. Since I made friends with all of y'all, y'all been good to me, we're going to do this. And since then, we kept building and building. I need your help, though, on this one. Say, let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Sabi ni Sir Gigo, kailangan namin kayo, ha? Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's, okay, when you hear that later, you're going to sing along with me. Because I'm going to tell you about this event called Picnic Games. And it's like, para siyang piyesta. Lahat invitado. Sobrang saya. Oh, here it is, man. Maybe I'll just perform it for y'all. It's a song. This one is, it's easier to perform rather than speaking like we were saying. We waited for this. Prayed for a day that would stay like today. What a wish, if I may. Thank God for the way He commits to those who stay dreaming. While our legacy is rich, few faces, new teams. There were old vets, young teens, wearing new J's, new jeans, Asians, Europeans. The whole damn place was packed with the coolest human beings. There were barbecue, someone painting on the wall. There were dancing crews, entertainment through it all. It was crazy dope. I showed nobody had to pay the girl. Really hope to make it grow large to be a major. So let's do this again, Diliman. Let's do this again every year. Let's do this again. Yeah, one more. Let's do this again and again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Yeah. Look. Man's cash, I handed them Kobe's. Man hits from half court, I handed them Kobe's. Looking around, what does it show me? Reminder of Brooklyn, Island called Coney. The DJs killed the turntables at will. The players were ill, displaying their skills. I was able to chill. Glad y'all enjoyed it. That was avoided. Only if the world can see, they wouldn't believe what we achieved this weekend. A perfect spot to meet new friends. A day that's hard to see end. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Yes, let's do this again. It's the sharing that got LeBron to come. That's all I can say. Yes, yes, the sing-along capabilities. Perhaps on my back you can pat me. Everybody went back home so happy. Every single one had a story of their own. They were lucky if they got to take a picture by the stone with the painted wings. It ain't my thing, but it makes me sing. How I feel like a god over the greatest king. It's insane cause it didn't rain. And it wouldn't be the same if it did up in the picnic games. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's see the hands now, going like this. That was fun, yeah. Let's do this again. Oh, maybe I should video this. Or picture for Instagram, yes. Let's do this again. Only if the world could see it, they wouldn't believe what we achieved this weekend. A perfect spot to see friends, a day that's hard to see, and let's do it again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Let's do this again. Only if the world can see, they wouldn't believe what we achieved this weekend. A perfect spot to see friends, a day that's hard to see end. Let's do it again. And I know your time is precious and you never get it back. The day that I turn TEDx talks into TEDx raps.
Time to bring the bass back. Mix is the beat of our culture. Our stories.
So I see myself having a couple number ones, number one albums.
Spotlight. spotlighting inspiring content from Generation Mix, the next generation of creators, artists, and filmmakers. Our music. Discover fresh artists first from around the world. Uniquely Filipino.
It's hard to get this energy anywhere else.
Mix is the beat of our culture.
Yeah. 1, 2, Rex, I'ma blow that. 3, 4, 5, I'ma hold that. Hold that. 6, 7, 8, I'ma show that. Show that. Show that.
This was a big week for our community, from merch drops to preparing for the historic election. I'm Kelly, here to fill you in on this week's hot list.
TikTok star turned influencer Bella Poarch officially dropped her own merch. For her first launch, which took place Wednesday, Bella made her merch available in limited quantities for a limited time. Her sweatsuit collaboration with LA-based clothing store Rip and Dip was available for only 24 hours, while she only had a limited supply of her black hoodie up for grabs.
It's M to the B, it's M to the B, it's M to the B, it's M to the B. Bang.
Bella rose to fame earlier this year after her video lip-syncing went viral on TikTok, making it one of the most viewed. Prior to being a TikTok star, Bella served in the U.S. Navy, so her launch comes just in time to celebrate Veterans Day next week. TFC's Collective Hustle is getting ready to launch their website, and what better way to celebrate than with a launch party? Partnering with Mix, Collective Hustle will live stream their event featuring Nadine Lustre, So Super Sam, Gabe Bondoc, Miles Medina, and a lot more. Collective Hustle's new site will feature various inspirational interviews with industry experts, masterclasses, and events tailored for the next gen of Filipinx creatives. You can join the party Thursday on CollectiveHustle.com and Mix Global on Kumu. This year's Larry It Leong Festival by the Filipino Workers Center kicked off last week on Manong Larry's birthday with a curbside pickup farmers market by the Filipino Farmers Cooperative from Orsi, California. Part 2 of the event wraps up on Saturday with a virtual celebration featuring Leia Salonga, Ruby Ibarra, Jules Arora, Inigo Pascual, and more. You can join this free event through Facebook, Zoom, or Kumu.
Many of you know this year's election was like no other, and people from our community either ran for office or made sure you got outvoted.
America's finest city is now on the verge of being America's biggest city to elect a Filipino-American mayor. San Diego elected California Assemblyman Todd Gloria to be its next mayor. If his big 13-point lead holds up, Gloria, whose grandfather came to San Diego from the Philippines to serve in the military, will be the city's first mayor of color and first openly gay mayor. From the big city to the Minnesota suburb of Maplewood, disability rights advocate and community organizer Nikki Villavicencio finished first place in the race for city council. Villavicencio, who was born with arthrohiposis, campaigned through the snow in a wheelchair, motivated to make a difference in the community. And the Daly City Council former mayor and current vice mayor, Jocelyn Manalo, is on her way to securing her re-election. Just a reminder, until officials count all the mail-in ballots and verify the results, these counts and projected victories are still unofficial. And while many people hit the polls during this historic election, many folks from our community helped make it happen. In San Diego, J.R. Amor led the county registrar's Philam Vote program that provides Filipino language ballots to voters. This year, 18,000 residents asked for Filipino voting material. AJ Raphael used his voice for a series of Get Out the Vote initiatives, and filmmaker John Agustavo teamed up with Move On to produce this short video set to the Carlos Bulosan poem, Let Them Know What We Are.
We are the men and women searching in the pages of history for the lost word, the key to the mystery of living peace.
People killing, people dying, children hurting, you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach?
And the Black Eyed Peas teamed up with Jennifer Hudson to put a new twist to their classic Where's the Love with The Love, which features many of the social issues driving people to vote.
Where is the love?
What's wrong with the world?
And that's this week's Hot List. Thanks for watching. Check out more of our videos on Instagram, Facebook, or YouTube. See you all next time.